Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to Artispace Books and Talks. Very happy to have our first kind of main event here today in association with the project we have at 38 Green Street, Radical Localism, Art, Video and Culture from Pueblo Nuevo's Mexicali Roads. I'd first like to say how happy we've been to be able to work with Mexicali Roads in this project and with Chris Krause. It's been a real pleasure to work with everybody and really great to have you in New York and working in the space, so thank you. And tonight, I mean, this afternoon's event is part of a two-day symposium in relation to the project called The City Machine and Its Streets, Anomalous Ecologies, something that Chris Krause has worked on as part of this project. And we're very happy to have a number of really exciting speakers today and tomorrow as well. We'll be screening some of the films from Mexicali Roads from the students who work with Mexicali Roads tomorrow afternoon, and also a film by Bernardo Ruiz called Reportero in the early evening. But this afternoon we have two kind of panel discussions, if you like, or talks with Sergio Haro Cordero, Marco Vieira, Israel Ortega. First of all, which I'm going to pass over to Chris Krause to introduce, and then the second part of the afternoon will be with Sergio Gonzalez-Rodriguez and then Aaron Wright. So I'll pass straight over to Chris to give more information on the topic.
Sure. Hi, thanks for very much for coming, and to everybody who came up from Mexicali to make this happen. The first panel that we have today, our idea was to present not just the gallery, I mean, we want to talk about the gallery and what the gallery is doing as a community center, but within the context of the community, you know, the history, what makes Mexicali unique, and we're really lucky to have Sergio Haro here to talk about that. And then Marco and Israel will talk more specifically about the gallery and the art scene in Mexicali. Sergio Haro was here partly for this event and also partly for screenings of the Bernardo Ruiz film Reportero that features his incredibly, you know, modest and heroic work with the newspaper Zeta that's based in Tijuana. Sergio is the Mexicali editor of Zeta News Magazine, which has been one of the leading media outlets to cover politics and the narco wars in Baja California. Sergio is like a veteran journalist. He's been working as a photographer and journalist since 1985. And in the course of his career, he's worked for the daily newspaper Crónica. He started several publications, including a news magazine called 7 Days. And he's worked also for Zeta for many years, going back and forth between Mexicali and Tijuana. His photographs have been collected into a book called the Chavo River, the La Mirada Desquieta, the Chavo Gaze, I don't think we quite arrived at a translation, but there's a beautiful book of his photographic work forthcoming. That really kind of spans the gamut of what he does, you know, from the earthquake to assassinations to people selling tamales on the corner to, you know, incidents in the narco wars. All of this comes into the purview of Sergio Haro's work. There's also an anthology coming out from the University of Baja California Press of some of his reporting gathered from over the years. So Sergio is going to give us kind of a history and context of the city of Mexicali. Marco Vieira, who I met, I guess, for the first time 2 or 3 years ago, lived in LA for a few years after going to San Diego State, but in 2006 decided to leave LA and go back to Pueblo Nuevo, where he was from, to start this community media center and gallery, Mexicali Roads, which quickly took off. I mean, though it began as like, his original intention was to teach media production to local kids, but it soon became kind of an all-purpose school, an art gallery, a meeting place for people from both sides of the border, and more lately, a radio station. So Marco is going to talk a little bit about the activities and founding of the space and how it works. Israel Ortega has been, for a long time now, a close collaborator of Mexicali Rose. Israel works as a curator and installer at the State Cultural Center in Mexicali. They're amazingly, I mean, it's just like this is always for Americans when we leave and go to other countries. It's so astonishing to us how well set up they are for the arts. You know, there's a municipal gallery, there's the state gallery, there's the national gallery. Israel worked at the State Cultural Center, as well as at Mexicali Rose, and I think he's going to talk a little bit about the relation between the more institutionally funded places like his, you know, museum, and the alternative scene that he's also a part of. So I think that's it. Thank you very much.
Okay, I'm going to thank the invitation. I'm going to thank Chris and Richard and all the people from the artist space. I know they are working very hard to this exhibition and the symposium. And I'm going to try to explain about Mexicali for the people who don't know Mexicali, what has happened in the last years. And I'm going to explain it in Spanish because I feel more comfortable. Sorry. And that's it. I'm working as a recording photographer, as Chris said, was 27 years in Mexicali, in the older the Baja, and I'm gonna try to explain you about what has happened in this area. In español, pues, Mexicali, I'm gonna explain as a reporter, not as a historian. Mexicali tiene alrededor de 100 años, 109 años como ciudad. Some people ask, why you live in Mexicali? There's a lot of, in the summer it's hot, more than 120 degrees in the summer, and very cold in the winter, and with earthquakes, with a lot of problems in the city. Why do you live in Mexicali? What's the importance to live in Mexicali? That's that. The main question that I'm going to try to responder. Mexicali. Mexicali es una zona, como ya todos saben, en la parte del sur, en la parte norte, es la ciudad más al norte de México, que tiene, es una ciudad fronteriza que está en la frontera con el Valle Imperial, que es el del sur de California. Y el Mexicali nació junto con el Valle Imperial, es una de las zonas agrícolas más importantes de todo el mundo y de todo Estados Unidos. En el caso de Mexicali, que nació hace alrededor de, decíamos, hace un poco más de 100 años, 109 años, la fundación tuvo que ser por cuestiones agrícolas y la parte que tuvo que ver, obviamente, con compañías norteamericanas que eran las dueñas de las tierras en aquel tiempo, la Colorado Riverland Company.
Mexicali is an area, as everybody knows, that it's the most northern city within the Mexico, that is a border town and borders Imperial Valley in Southern California. And it was born around 190 years ago. And it's a very, Imperial Valley is a very important agricultural center, one of the most important agricultural areas in the world and in the US. So when Mexicali was founded 109 years ago, its founding, the establishment of the city had to do with agricultural reasons, and particularly with US companies that were settling there. Particularly the Colorado River Land Company was one of the big landowners in the area.
Y algunos hechos curiosos tienen que ver, por ejemplo, cómo esta compañía norteamericana prefería contratar emigrantes, en el caso de gente que venía de la India, japoneses, chinos, por la cuestión de la situación de la revolución que estaba pasando en China, hubo mucha migración hacia América, y ustedes lo saben aquí en el caso de Nueva York, en el caso de otras ciudades de Estados Unidos, como San Francisco, como Los Ángeles, y de esa parte también llegaron a Mexicali, porque también iban a campos agrícolas como los de Sinaloa, y de repente llegaron a Mexicali. Mexicali, la comunidad china, es una parte importante de su historia, sobre todo en la zona del centro, en donde ahora todavía existe un barrio que se llama La Chinesca. Y
American companies would prefer to use migrant labor from India or Japan or China, and particularly because of the revolution taking place in China at that time, there was a lot of immigration to the Americas, and you've seen that in the US, particularly in New York and San Francisco and LA area, and those immigrants would also arrive in Mexicali and in Sinaloa to work in the fields. And in Mexicali in particular, the Chinese community is very important, and there's still a neighborhood downtown identified as the local Chinatown.
Y en ese tiempo también la producción algodonera en Mexicali era una de las más importantes del mundo. De hecho, algunas gentes lo llamaban el rancho algodonero más grande del mundo. Y eso implicaba pues que atraía, por la cuestión económica, por supuesto, a gente de todas partes, pero fue hasta alrededor de 1930-38 exactamente cuando el gobierno mexicano, con un presidente que algunos caracterizaban de izquierda, como fue Lázaro Cárdenas, le quitó la tierra a los inversionistas norteamericanos y se le repartió a la gente de la zona, creando lo que son los ejidos, que es una especie de parcelas colectivas que hasta la fecha actualmente funcionan, claro, ahora con una situación de bastante crisis con lo que ha pasado en todo el mundo, ¿no?
So, back then, Mexicali was a very important cotton producing center, one of the most important in the world. Many people refer to it as one of these cotton producing centers, and it would attract a lot of people because of the amount of money, people from all over the world. And in the 30s, in 1938 to be exact, there was a Mexican president that some people regard as left-leaning, Lázaro Cárdenas, who expropriated the land from the U.S. companies and gave it to the people in the area, establishing what is called the ejidos, which are collective plots of land that currently are going through a crisis and very precarious as in most parts of the world.
Eso permitió una época muy fuerte de crecimiento basado en la cuestión de la agricultura en la zona del Valle de Mexicali. Pero bueno, no solamente es la cuestión de la agricultura que está también en crisis como muchas otras áreas, sino por ejemplo también durante años después se establecieron, como igual que lo sucedido en muchas ciudades del norte del país, maquiladoras, es decir, ya sabemos, son compañías extranjeras de varias partes del mundo que se llegan y establecen una parte del proceso, pero no todo. A veces la gente que trabaja ahí no sabe exactamente qué es lo que están produciendo, y esas se establecieron igual que en otras partes de la frontera, igual en la zona de Mexicali, ¿no? Que actualmente las maquiladoras, el agro y otras áreas que, en las que se mueve la actividad económica fundamentalmente con toda la crisis que se vive mundialmente, ¿no?
Back then, in that time, there was a lot of growth agriculturally in the Mexicali Valley, and then right now there's crisis in that area and also in other areas that were established later to promote economical activity. Both in Mexicali and in other northern towns, for example, the factory centers known as maquiladoras, which, as you know, are factory centers established by foreign companies that transfer to that area part of the factory process, but not all of it, so much so that some people working in the factories don't even know what the company is actually producing.
Y bueno, parte sintetizada de Mexicali, solamente para contextualizar, en estas últimas, ¿qué serían los últimos, más o menos, que 40 años? Ha habido también una serie de movimientos sociales importantes en la región y que incluyen a Mexicali. Y bueno, y un elemento importante también hay que tomar en cuenta, como la mayoría de las ciudades del norte de México, que jalan mucha migración de los estados de un lado, en el caso de Sonora, Sinaloa, pero no son los únicos. También hay estados del sur del país, como Oaxaca, Guerrero, Chiapas, en donde fluye bastante el flujo migratorio de comunidades indígenas que en una buena parte ni siquiera hablan español y que van a trabajar a los campos agrícolas de la zona del sur de Ensenada, en San Quintín, y que de repente son miles.
Another thing, this is just a small summary of how Mexicali is and how it works, and something that has happened in the last 40 years, more or less. There's been a number of social movements in the region, including Mexicali, that are pretty relevant. One thing that happens in Mexicali, as in most other northern Mexican cities is that there is migration both from the states to the east and west of it, like Sinaloa, and also from the states to the south, like Oaxaca, Guerrero, and Chiapas, from which a lot of the people that come belong to Indian communities, people that don't even speak Spanish and just migrate in big groups to work in the fields in places like Ensenada and San Quintín.
Esa es la parte que viene de la zona más al sur de México. Pero hay otra parte de los estados ahí cercanos. El caso está en que en Mexicali hay mucha gente que va tratando de cruzar a Estados Unidos, mucha gente que no va a cruzar a Estados Unidos, pero que va buscando mejores condiciones de vida. Entonces se hace así como que, ¿cómo decirlo? Un mosaico en términos pues migratorios que ha hecho interesante, por ejemplo, en términos culturales, que lo que más adelante un poco se va a abordar. Y también ha habido una serie de movimientos sociales importantes en la región y que incluyen Mexicali, por ejemplo, en los tiempos en que el Partido Único era el gobernante, ellos tenían el control de los movimientos obreros, pero ha habido movimientos obreros independientes, como el caso de las maquiladoras, como el caso de la Coca-Cola, como el caso de Pepsi-Cola, como el caso incluso de la universidad, que atravesó una de las huelgas más importantes y que paralizó la universidad hace alrededor de 30 años. Yo soy parte de esa generación y que el gobierno lo aplastó de golpe.
So that's something, the Indian community migration is something that has to do mostly with the southern Mexico states, but then there's also migration into Mexicali from the bordering states, both from people who have the intention to crossing over to the US and people who have no intention of crossing over and just want to improve their lot. So that makes Mexicali like a mosaic of many immigrant arrivals. And it's very interesting also from a cultural standpoint, as it's going to be addressed by the other panelists later. And then there's also the social movements that happen in the region, including Mexicali. And back when the PRI was the governing party, it had control, for example, over the worker movements, but not all of them. So there were also independent worker movements, including what happened in the maquiladoras and at Coca-Cola and Pepsi-Cola and in the university. Which I was a part of. There was a very important strike that happened about 30 years ago and was crushed relentlessly by the government.
Sí, y bueno, esa es en la parte social. Y en la parte política electoral, por ejemplo, en Baja California, ya muchos deben de saber que fue el primer estado en donde un partido diferente al PRI ganó las elecciones en 1989, en Baja California, en donde fue en 1994, fue asesinado el candidato priista Luis Donaldo Colosio, que también a mí me tocó estar en ese evento por circunstancias ahí de mi trabajo periodístico, y en donde el PAN tiene más de 20 años gobernando, pero que ya ha empezado a perder el poder, eso en términos políticos electorales.
And then, in terms of the social, that's in terms of the social movements. That's there also the aspect of the electoral politics in Baja California, which, as many of you may know, was the first state where a party other than the PRI came into power. That was in 1989. Then, in 1994, the presidential candidate Luis Donaldo Colosio was killed in Tijuana. And just by a matter of chance, I was there during the event because of my work as a journalist. Then the PAN has also been in power now for 20 years, but it has started losing some of the areas of government lately.
Y otra de las partes que tienen que ver desafortunadamente con lo que pasa actualmente ya en unas buenas zonas de México es la cuestión de la inseguridad, de la violencia. Por la ubicación geopolítica de Mexicali, que está pegado a Sonora y que estamos pegados a California y Arizona, es una zona natural de flujo de droga y que ha implicado el pleito por el control de esa zona entre los diversos grupos y que ha ocasionado muchísima violencia en toda esa región. Y que,
And another thing that unfortunately has had a lot of impact in Mexicali and in many areas of Mexico lately is the lack of safety, the violence. And because of the particular location of Mexicali, which is next to Sonora and next to Arizona and California, that makes it a natural passageway for the movement of drugs. And that has generated a lot of fighting among the different drug trafficking groups, has generated a lot of violence in the area. From groups trying to get control of the drug routes.
Entonces, esto un tanto como que cambió el panorama en términos, pues, de la inseguridad, de la incidencia delictiva, y es lo que nos ha estado tocando. Mucha gente conoce lo que ha pasado en Tijuana, pero esto también ha pasado en Mexicali, no igual que el mismo ritmo y el mismo impacto, pero también ha habido situaciones bastante complicadas que tienen que ver con la delincuencia y con la mafia del crimen organizado.
So that's something that has changed in terms of safety and in terms of crime, and many people have heard of what's going on in Tijuana, and the same kind of things are happening in Mexicali, not at the same pace, but in the same kind of way, and having to do with organized crime and violence and just mafia activity in general.
Y en la mayoría de los casos, y esa es una de las partes que tienen que ver con lo que a mí me toca trabajar, sale a flote la corrupción de las autoridades policíacas de los diferentes niveles municipales, estatales y federales, siempre que se detectan y se detienen agentes involucrados con el narcotráfico, emergen policías que los protegían, emergen policías que los escoltaban, emergen policías que en vez de estar del lado ciudadano, están exactamente del lado contrario, que tiene que ver con la protección a esta gente.
And in most of the cases, and that's something that has to do directly with my work as a journalist, something that has a direct impact in this violence is the corruption of the police at every level, municipal, state, and federal. And every time a drug trafficker is arrested, up come all the police agents that were protecting this person and that were working in conjunction with the drug traffickers, either providing protection or working as bodyguards or just taking care of their business side and basically being on the side of the drug traffickers instead of the side of the citizenship.
Y solamente voy a mencionar algunos ejemplos, solamente como unos, ahora sí que botones de muestra, como decimos, como el caso del ex jefe de la policía en Mexicali, que actualmente se encuentra en un penal de máxima seguridad y que fue, trascendió que era parte del grupo protector en aquel tiempo del cártel de Tijuana que operaba en Mexicali, por donde pasaban toneladas y toneladas de cocaína que iban hacia el sur de California y obviamente que venían hacia Estados Unidos. Y el jefe de la policía era uno de sus principales, el jefe de la policía municipal, después trascendió, después lo detuvieron y actualmente todavía está en una prisión federal en el centro del país.
So I can give you a number of examples just as tokens of this phenomenon. For example, one would be the former chief of the municipal police in Mexicali, who is now serving a sentence in a maximum security prison. It was learned that he was actually engaged in the protection for the cartel de Tijuana, which was the one in control of Mexicali at that point, and through Mexicali would pass tons and tons of cocaine en route to Southern California. So first there were rumors, and then this chief of police was arrested and the investigation was conducted, and he ended up serving a term in a maximum security prison.
Y otro caso fue el de un ex comandante de la policía judicial, eso lo publicamos nosotros en Zeta, y es parte también del film de lo que aparece en el Mañana Reportero. Un ex jefe de la policía que fue parte de la escolta del gobernador Ernesto Rufo, que fue detenido por el grupo contrario, le hicieron una entrevista y le grabaron y después fue encontrado muerto, asesinado a golpes en frente de la casa de la novia del procurador. Él decía que era parte del cártel de Sinaloa, encabezaba una célula y que tenían el apoyo del procurador general del estado.
And another case would be the case of a former commander of the judicial police, and this was something that was covered in Zeta magazine and is also mentioned in one of the films. And it turned out that this person was also a bodyguard for the governor, Ernesto Rufo. He got detained by people from the opposing cartel, and they conducted an interview and videotaped it. And then his body appeared in front of the house of the public prosecutor's girlfriend. And it turned out that he was a member of the Sinaloa cartel, and the cartel itself had the protection of this public prosecutor.
Entonces, él era un grupo de ex policías que trabajaban para el cartel de Sinaloa, que traían un pleito con policías y ex policías que les estaban robando droga y que estuvieron asesinando alrededor de 10, 12 ahí en Mexicali.
So this was basically a group of former policemen, a group of former policemen who were working for the Sinaloa cartel, and who got into a fight or a disagreement with another group of former and current police were stealing drugs from them and who had been killing steadily like 10 or 12 different people in and around the area of Mexicali.
Y otro caso que también sucedió ahí en Mexicali fue un atentado que hubo contra el secretario de Seguridad Pública en el estado que vivía en Mexicali, donde un grupo de alrededor de, se calcula entre 30 y 40 sicarios, le pusieron una emboscada alrededor de 4 cuadras por los dos lados, lo estaban esperando una mañana en abril del 2006. Al secretario lo salvó que iba en una camioneta blindada, a su escolta les tiraron una granada que les abrió un boquete en la camioneta y a los tres escoltas quedaron heridos. Y el secretario alcanzó, por la pericia de su guardaespaldas chofer y por la blindada, alcanzó a escapar sin ningún herido.
And another case that was pretty notorious was an attempt against the Secretary of Public State Safety who lived in Mexicali. It was an ambush by a group of like 30 or 40 hitmen who were ambushing him and had covered an area of like 4 blocks on each side. This was in 2006. And what saved him was that he was traveling in an armored van or SUV. And one group of his bodyguards were actually hit by a grenade, and that opened like a big hole in their van, and they were all injured. But he was lucky that his driver was very talented, and he managed to escape.
Ese es un caso muy sonado en Mexicali, pero además es parte también de lo que incluyo en el libro que se está preparando. Y uno de los guardias fue el que alcanzó a combatir a los agresores y resulta que le tiraron un segundo granadazo, eso me lo platicó él, cuando me lo platica todavía llora y dice que tiene como 8 balas en el cuerpo, le tiraron un segundo granadazo que él no se dio cuenta y de repente sintió un golpe en el estómago y cayó, pero por la panza, no tronó y vio que cayó y miró que era una granada. Y el que de todos quedó herido y pensaron que lo habían matado, pero ellos sobrevivieron.
And that was a very notorious case, and that's included in a book that is in process, a notorious case in Mexicali. And there was one of the bodyguards in particular who was one of the ones, or the one that was able to fight against the hitman. And he received the second impact from a grenade, and he was telling me this and was crying while he was telling the story. Saying that he still had like 8 fragments of bullets in his body, and that he didn't even realize he had been hit with a grenade until he felt like the hit in his stomach and looked down and realized it was a grenade.
Y bueno, hay otro caso que eso es más reciente y eso estaba pasando en Mexicali durante los últimos 3-4 años, en donde han sido asesinadas mujeres que se dedican a la prostitución y no hay una cifra exacta durante los, pero por lo menos se reconocen alrededor de 8 o 9 muertas, que no solamente fueron asesinadas, sino que en algunos de los casos fueron descuartizadas, decapitadas, encontradas en pedazos, y en donde el gobierno del estado ha insistido en que no se trata de un asesino serial. Han sido detenidos, ha habido otros casos en donde han sido detenidos algunos de los novios de las mujeres. A uno lo encontraron después de 3-4 días de estar fumando cristal, lo encontraron cuando fue a tirar el cuerpo de la mujer en una bolsa negra de basura, lo tenía en un closet durante 2 o 3 días y estaba completamente ondeado, como decimos nosotros, por el cristal. Obviamente que lo detuvieron.
So another case, another recent case that has happened in Mexicali in the last 3-4 years has been the killing of women who were working as prostitutes. There's no exact figure of this, but there's been at least 8 or 9 dead, and some of them had not only been killed but been chopped into pieces, or you know, the body was found headless. And the state government has insisted that there's no serial killer behind this. A number of, you know, the boyfriends were arrested. One of them in particular was arrested after like 3 or 4 days of smoking crystal meth when he went to dump the body in a black trash bag. And he had had the body for 2 or 3 days inside a closet. And he was, you know, very high at the moment.
Los grupos de apoyo a las mujeres y de apoyo a los grupos de homosexuales y hay grupos que han estado insistiendo ante la Procuraduría de que se trata de la misma persona en los otros casos, y la Procuraduría ha insistido en que son situaciones diferentes. y no se ha detenido en esos casos a ninguno. Ellos dicen que incluso hay un grupo de mujeres que están desaparecidas, por eso no sé si sabe exactamente cuántas son, porque algunas, como son migrantes también, no tienen familia, viven en los hoteles del centro de la ciudad, nadie sabe qué pasó con ellas, pero de repente no recuperan ni siquiera sus cosas. Se calcula que hay por lo menos otras 10 mujeres desaparecidas durante los últimos meses.
So a number of groups, support groups for women or for gay rights, have been insisting that there's just one person behind all these crimes, but the public prosecutor's office is insisting that there's none, that there's all of them are separate situations. There's been no arrests, and also another problem is that there's a number of women who are simply presented as missing, because since they were also migrant workers and didn't have families and would live in the downtown hotels, they would simply just disappear from one day to the next, not even go back to pick up their stuff.
Incluso,
so there's another 10 or so that are considered missing.
Incluso se ha denunciado durante los últimos dos meses, o dos mujeres fueron levantadas, golpeadas, una pensaron que estaba muerta y la dejaron tirada ahí cerca del centro, otra la tiraron en un canal en la orilla de Mexicali, alcanzó a sobrevivir y no quiso ni siquiera poner la denuncia, lo que quiso es desaparecerse, pero con estos grupos sí alcanzó a comentarles lo que había pasado. Tremendamente golpeada, pero sobrevivió.
So, even in the last 2 months, there's been two complaints of two women who were basically just like kidnapped in the street and beaten up. One of them was left for dead, and the other one was dumped in a canal on the outskirts of Mexicali. One of them didn't want to present a complaint, and she was badly beaten up, but somehow survived.
Esto es solamente,
put a complaint with these support groups.
Esto es solamente así como que un panorama así muy apresurado de la realidad de Mexicali, que no solamente obviamente es violencia y son asesinatos y es droga y ese tipo de cosas. También en Mexicali es una ciudad donde la gente se caracteriza por el temple, por la fortaleza, pero desafortunadamente no hay, el gobierno está en un camino diferente al de la mayoría de la gente, y lo podemos ver por ejemplo en el caso del Valle de Mexicali, en donde mucha de la economía de Mexicali depende del Valle, pero en el Valle no hay espacios culturales, no hay ni siquiera cines, no hay ni siquiera, lo único que hay son una especie de cantinas rurales que le llaman juntas de mejoras, donde de repente los fines de semana encontramos a los chavos desde a las 10 de la mañana que abren. O sea, el único, y si yo lo digo sin ningún ánimo moralista, ¿no? El único espacio cultural son las juntas de mejora, las cantinas en el Valle de Mexicali.
So this is just like a quick sketch of Mexicali. And Mexicali, of course, is not only like violence and killings and drugs. I mean, it's also a city where people are very resilient and very strong. Unfortunately, the government seems to pull in a different direction of what most people would want. And one example of that is the Mexicali Valley. The economy of Mexicali depends a lot on the valley. However, the valley has no cultural spaces at all, no cultural centers, no movie theaters, nothing really. The only thing are these kind of rural canteens called Junta de Mejoras. And from 10 a.m. on, when they open, you just see young men drinking there. And I don't see this in any way trying to be moralizing, but there's no any other cultural or meaning space.
Y en este panorama, y también se va a hablar sobre la situación de la política de Estado en términos de la cultural y todo eso, creo que es importante el surgimiento de espacios culturales independientes. En el caso de Mexicali Rose es uno de los ejemplos, que no es el único, pero son escasos. Está uno otro que se llama Nanachela, otro que está en otra parte, no sé exactamente, en una zona de Infonavit, una zona muy popular, pero podemos contar con los dedos de una mano los espacios independientes, y posteriormente Marco hablaría sobre eso. Pero yo creo que estamos viendo una realidad no muy agradable, por un lado, y por otro lado, ¿qué hacer ante todo eso? El gobierno ha sido más policías, más patrullas, más armas, más ampliar los lugares de las cárceles. Y bueno, hace falta la creación de estos espacios para ofrecerles algo a los jóvenes, no solamente entretenerlos, sino algo, ir formando a las nuevas generaciones, que eso es parte del trabajo, y a mí me parece muy importante lo que ha hecho Mark.
And this is just a quick sketch, and they're going to talk about also state policies in terms of cultural policy, but I just wanted to mention that there's just a few really independent cultural centers There's one called Ananachela and another one which is located in Infonavit, which is like a popular neighborhood. And there's Mexicali Rose, of course, but there's not many of them. You can count them with the fingers in one hand. And when you are faced with this situation, which is not good, you ask yourself, what should you do? And the policies from the government have simply been, you know, to increase the number of policemen, to increase patrols, to increase the amount of weapons, to enlarge the jails. But the idea is, how could you create new spaces to offer something to the youth, not only in terms of entertainment, but in terms of education?
Y bueno, esa es la parte, en términos generales. La otra parte le tocaría comentar sobre el surgimiento del proyecto de Mikali Rose a Marco y a Israel sobre las políticas, un poco las políticas culturales. Esta sería así una fotografía a grandes rasgos sobre Mexicali, un poco para que la gente, para que ustedes pudieran ubicar lo que ha estado sucediendo y la muestra del trabajo cultural en el caso de la exposición que se abrió ayer y que tengo entendido que va a estar alrededor de 2 meses. Y esto sería en términos generales mi participación, y agradecer la grandiosa traducción muy rápida, muy puntual.
These are just general comments in terms of Mexicali, and Marco and Israel are going to go into more detail about cultural policies and what's been happening in that. And this is just basically a broad strokes for you guys to be able to have a general idea of Mexicali and understand the context where the exhibit that started yesterday is coming from, and all the cultural work these guys have been doing. And it's my understanding the exhibit is going to be open for 2 months, so that's basically the gist of my participation. I want to thank everybody, thank the translator.
And I just a little bit of that, I want to say I'm proud to be here to talk about my city, my Mexicali, my people. Thank you again for the invitation.
Well, hi, my name is Marco, and I'm the director and founder of the Mexicali Rose Media Arts Center. And I wanted to say that we're also very honored to have Sergio here with us, explaining some of the context in which we've developed. And he's been around really supporting young writers and people that want to say what's really happening in the city. So we're really honored to have him here as a sort of an emblem of freedom of expression, which is how we started. We really wanted Mexicali Rose to be a place where kids could go and have a place where they could express what they're going through as young people in a place that's very challenging, which is the U.S.-Mexico border. And basically, we came from a place where we didn't have any cultural centers. The closest thing that we had like that growing up was basically sort of like a makeshift punk rock shows or DIY fanzines and stuff like that. So it was basically trying to build your own scene, trying to build it from scratch. And that's a lot of the spirit of the Mexicali people. Is just basically we don't wait for big grants or big money or stuff like that. We're always trying to build something from nothing, and that's what we wanted to do. I also think that there's a big crisis in education, not just in Mexicali, but I think worldwide. I think the way people, the education systems around the world are working is they're just kind of very industrial. They're, you know, fill the classes as much as they can with a lot of students, and they're just trying to churn them out in like a factory-like sort of fashion. We didn't want that for our community. We wanted a place that was more hands-on, more personal, where kids could go and learn art and freedom of expression. So we feel like arts courses in not just Mexicali, but in a lot of places are very expensive, very elitist. And we wanted to have a place where everything was free. And we consider ourselves media activists. I think the way video has worked with a lot of these kids, it's more immediate. And that way they can reflect their surroundings a little more through this medium, which we were hoping to provide. Since the beginning, when Mexicali Rose started, the initial idea was just to be an audiovisual production workshop for kids to do documentaries and experimental video. And that was our initial goal. That's been sort of like our great success. And basically offer some sort of alternative for kids in junior high and high school ages. Basically, a lot of people, I don't think, can afford college. I think college fees are soaring everywhere. Like even in this city, you know, a lot of these people that are up with the Occupy movements and stuff like that, a lot of them are up to here in college debt. You know, it's very expensive to go to school, and I don't think that's the way things should be. So we were trying to offer some sort of alternative. Possibly not a college degree. We don't really give grades. We don't really have those sort of deadlines where, you know, it's just sort of more by the book and the way you work. We just want it to be more organic, more of a human connection, more of kids just being able to express themselves. And like Sergio mentioned, these are some pretty troubled times, and it just seems to be unfortunately getting worse. So I feel like sometimes as the situation worsens, kids will try to find more alternatives and try to get closer to us. Hopefully get bigger groups and more kids that are more critical. I think that the age groups that we manage is a time in their lives when they're developing a critical thinking, and we definitely don't want them to be sort of like part of that routine, which is work in a maquiladora or something like that, or you know, work in school if they could afford school. You know, I couldn't afford college. The reason why I went to college is actually a drunk American driver almost killed me in Mexico, so we used the settlement money and I was able to go to college. That's probably the only way I would have been able to afford it, really. During that time in college, I think it's always good to mention some of the people that inspired the space. And during the time when I was in college, I was very fortunate to be able to work on a documentary in Guatemala. And it was about this indigenous community, which is entirely autonomous. We went to cover them, and they were just got together and built their own schools. They built their own schools. They lived off of corn harvest, and basically they just eliminated all the corn harvest, got together and built schools, and it's a very remote village. They were able to build their own doctor's visits for the community. So that really inspired me in thinking these people don't really have money to eat sometimes, and they're going ahead and starting their own community. So I saw a lot of people, it was very beautiful having a lot of people that don't have much, not wait for the government to do stuff for them, but get together and do it in a way that's even better than some of the offers that are there institutionally. So that was one of the inspirations. Another one was when I was living in Los Angeles at the time. There's a great collective called Echo Park Film Center, and they're also media activists, which basically teach workshops for free. It's all audiovisual workshops for children in what was then a very troubled area in Los Angeles, which is Echo Park, which has now become very, very gentrified. And I think they're just one of the very last true voices left in that neighborhood, and they're really amazing, and they helped us get started. And another point how we got started is basically we'd see a lot of our friends going back to Mexicali doing workshops. For example, Rafael was doing workshops in Caoba, which is a young men's shelter. But what we saw happening was all of these workshops were sort of a lot of quantity, not quality. You couldn't really have a follow-up with some of those teenagers. And so we were talking one in our own space where we could, you know, it's not just the workshop's over, I'll see you later. You know, have some more continuity with these kids that would never ever dreamt of any sort of proximity to the arts. So we sort of started talking and got together, and we faced a lot of problems getting started. We wanted to be a 501c3 here in the States, but through the Patriot Act, it was just really, really tough. And so around that time, I just was very disillusioned with President Bush getting reelected, and just kind of wanted to go home and start something. So we didn't really wait. We just, everything was out of our own pockets. And we started the space, and we looked, at least conceptually, the idea. So when it came time to find an actual space, instead of renting something, my uncle, the neighborhood where we're set up is Pueblo Nuevo, and it's one of the oldest neighborhoods in Mexicali. It's also one of the most troubled because of its proximity with the border. There's a lot of kids that get sort of drafted into drug trade, and there's just a lot of people that are moving in. It's the oldest neighborhood. All the older generations either dying out, and people that are moving in are dedicating themselves to human trafficking. And that's what happened with the space that we had. It was an uncle's house, and basically this happened to him like two times. He would rent the space out to a nice family. Family would be there for 2 months, and all of a sudden it's these guys who were trafficking people, and they were really, I guess, sort of good at what they did. You never really saw much movement unless it was like 3 or 4 in the morning. And so we wanted to change that because a lot of those people were being held there against their will. So I even say, call them kidnappers, really. And so my uncle was very afraid. They hadn't paid rent for a year, and they wouldn't leave. So he said, if you're able to manage to get them out, then you guys can have the space and build, whatever it is you want to do. Even though it's kind of funny, he, had people that were smuggling drugs and people over to the States. But when we told him we wanted to do an art center that wouldn't charge a single dime, he kind of just didn't get it. So I think a lot of people just still don't get the concept of an entirely free education. And sometimes people think that you're a little crazy for trying to do something like that, which is more positive than what was going on. But we finally were able to, it was really tough and we were really persistent, but the people actually left. And I think we were both sort of eyeing each other and keeping an eye out on what each other was doing. One time I had to leave, go get some donations and come back, and I just jokingly asked my parents, because we live right next to the space, asked them if they had left, and she said yes. And I told her, well, they left the key, yeah, and I asked her if she had gone over there. She said, I don't want to go there. So I went there, and the place was just a terrible mess. It was not living conditions for anybody. Lots of fake passports, lots of fake IDs. People would write on the walls what different parts of Mexico they were from. Some from Central America, lots of airplane tickets, mostly from Michoacán. It seemed to be that's the area where they would bring the people over from. And I thought we were going to spend like 2 or 3 months fixing up the place, but it actually lasted about a year, because the place was really, really just in shambles. So that started going, and it was kind of time to work on our outreach. And we have like our friends that do workshops, like Rafael, another friend, Fernando Corona, Ramon Garcia Vasquez. They do workshops. They work in the prisons. They do workshops with children, and they do it in a more a way that's financed by the government, but definitely the way they work is very personal and humanist. So one of our friends, Ramon, asked if we could do a workshop there, and we hadn't really been set up entirely. We didn't really have the bathroom set up yet. So he said it was a muralism workshop and it would all be outside. So we just kind of did it in an old-fashioned way. We just rode our bikes, handed out flyers to the kids in the community, and they responded really well and came over to this muralism workshop and really, really put a lot of effort into it. They were just sort of thrown back as well. They said, how much is it gonna cost? This is like a government thing. I think everybody's just afraid, that it's a government thing, and they're gonna be labeled as taggers or graffiti and kind of get messed with. But they came over and they immediately became a part of the space. And even after that workshop was done, I'd still be, fixing up the place, and they would come over and ask to help. So they were a part of the space before it was even formally open. And once that happened, we started off with a video workshop, which was a very immediate response. And some of the videos that you'll see tomorrow are from the very first workshop. And I think that in a lot of the communities that are underprivileged or marginalized, that's where you have a lot of stories. And they don't have the outlets to be able to express these really intricate and beautiful stories about their families, about themselves, about their interests. So that's how we kind of got started with that, with the media workshop. And through that, just artists and people started flowing to the space. And basically a lot of our friends that are artists that are very, we think alike in the same sort of a social or political sense, they wanted to do workshops, and they also thought the space is pretty big, why don't we turn this into a gallery? And so I said, okay, let's go ahead and do that, because we didn't have an occupation for each room yet. So it turned into a gallery, and it just took off immediately. People really needed that sort of a alternative space to the institutions, which even some of the people that work in institutions like Israel started coming and working with us because it was a more such a freer method of work. And basically, even some of the people in institutions, they know what good art is or contemporary art, but they have to program certain type of user-friendly art as part of their, you know, sort of itineraries. So they were pretty excited about the space too. So it just became a bigger community, not just of children and teenagers from the neighborhood, but also of artists from all over the city. And we started to expand with the gallery, and we started inviting artists from out of town, artists from LA, from Tijuana, from San Diego, Hermosillo, San Francisco, and some tremendous art shows, really. A lot of different disciplines, graffiti, photography, there's even like printmaking, video, sculpture, yeah, just all the different disciplines. And these are all kids that aren't really, there's no commercial galleries down there, and so they just want to show the work. They come in, they put money out of their own pocket, and just really are hoping to be able to express themselves at the gallery, so that way really has taken off. And so we just kept on expanding, basically, and then we started another project, which was the Cine Club Las Palmitas, which is a cinema club. And there's a lot of traveling filmmakers. It's a really cool sort of scene of filmmakers that just will get in a van, and kind of like a band, just go and travel like around different parts. And we're trying to sort of become an obligatory tour stop there. And it's a lot of experimental films, and that really psychs the kids up to be able to produce different types of work. And so we've done that, hoping to screen Reportero pretty soon, and just kept growing through grants and through community support. And it's been entirely grassroots. And another project that we started, which we're really excited about, is Radio Pájaro Hombre, which is basically an uncensored radio station online where kids can go and express themselves. In the beginning, we thought it was just going to be, you know, underground music, non-conventional music that doesn't ever get played on the radio, commercial free, of course. But I think through like what Sergio said, it's a sign of the times where kids are really taking this as a sort of a social platform to discuss a lot of the issues that are happening politically. There's a lot of shows that try to be more proactive, try to get kids to go to all these manifestations. There's just been amazing, amazing programs, and these, nobody treats it like sort of like an alternative radio station. It's everybody goes there with these amazing shows that we just are very grateful to have. And that's basically been one of the newer projects that we're working on. And that was helped out by a lot of people from the United States. I think there's what we're trying to do is just sort of be no borders for art. There's a lot of collectives that we worked with, like Echo Park Film Center and killradio.org, which is just sort of like a radical radio station in Los Angeles. And we were very influenced by other independent media groups, such as the Paper Tiger Television here in New York. They're really amazing, and they sort of influenced us coming up. So basically, that sort of sums up our community, what we're about, what we're trying to put out there is freedom of expression in a time that's a time of crisis, really, for not just our city, but for the whole country. And basically, I think it's just a matter of if it's really easy to critique the media, to critique the lack of access to the media, but it's another thing to try to create, you know, a viable alternative to that. So that's basically been our mission, and we keep growing, and really excited to be here working with like-minded individuals here in New York, like Artist Space, and we're really just very excited to be able to share our story with you guys. So thank you very much.
Thank you. My name is Israel, and I'm part of
this project, as Marco said, and I'm very grateful for being a part of it, and I wish to start with giving thanks to ArtSpace and Chris Cross that made this possible for us, and the great crew that has been working with us this week and that have treated us like royalty. Thank you. And also, you showing up to hear our stories here in New York and what are we doing. I've been working as a curator, installer in the city's galleries and the state galleries of Baja California. Now, this is my 15th year, so it's my quinceañera. It's a great celebration for us here in New York. And in this time, we started a little project called the Alternative Spaces down in 97. And at that point, there was really no alternative spaces in Mexicali. And this was little money from the government. We used to put shows in like shopping malls and make like some artistic like shows, like music and dancing and stuff, and lobbies of hotels. And we managed to pretty much produce like 70 shows, like art shows and stuff, and in a span like 4 years. But then when the new government came, they shut down the program and they relocated me into the City Gallery, and I started working there since 2001. And at that point, we started developing the idea of having this opportunity to work outside the walls of the institution, because we think it's very important to educate people and to see art and how to appreciate art. And I think it's very important that they see it as something that is very new to them or to us. So that's why, and when I met Marco in 2008, I immediately was up to the idea of working in a space like Mexicali Rose. Fortunately, we have become pretty much close and to working together and doing whatever we can to make the community be able to work with kids and stuff, and I mean welcoming everybody to the art scene. That's mainly what drives us. That's mainly what we want to do, is to be a part of this scene. That's alternative, but I think it's pretty much taking over the institution scene in Mexicali right now. Because of the creation of the School of Arts, we also have like a new batch of artists, young artists there, and they are creating new spaces and stuff. We currently have, I think, like 8 spaces in Mexicali opening. Pretty much Mexicali Rose is like the leader, because everyone wants to see what Marco has done, and everybody is asking for like the way to go. It is very fortunate that in a very minimal part, at least, we can be like a part of it as an aspect of working in an institution where I get paid not too much, but I get paid to do what I love. So my spare time, if I have it, I spend it trying to do this type of work in everywhere where everywhere we can. There is a relation between institutions and alternative spaces. It really has to be a better relationship. I think we are together setting many of the I don't know, basis to build up this relationship and maybe one day have as institutions that are publicly funded and the money comes from the government, we have more money to put in alternative space like Marcos, like Mexicali Rose, and hopefully we have a big program that it's only dedicated to this work for the greater of the community, for the development of the community. I also think, like Marco, that it's very important that education is in crisis, but we still want to take in our own hands to try and do something about it, not just be criticizing and saying, well, this is wrong and that's wrong. We are really trying to work, and we work a lot to make that concept of, trying to get this stuff done. Not even asking maybe institutions, but trying to do it by ourselves, and it's pretty much how we are working. I don't know, we made numerous shows in LA and San Diego and the obviously in the Imperial Valley and in other states of Mexico, and we've been doing it with only what we have, I think it's very important to keep on doing it, because this is opening new doors, the chance to be here in New York and do this show and work with such professional people, and we're in the big leagues now, and I hope that this is the start of something very good for all the work that Marco has put in and for all the guys that are back there and are the artists that make this possible. So I think pretty much that.
Thank you very much, all of you. That was really fascinating. We have time left if people would like to ask questions. Anyone? Questions or comments or declarations?
Can I ask a question, Chris? I wanted to ask Marco and Israel slightly about, maybe this is question you haven't really had, you're dealing with, maybe it's a bit more day-to-day thing, but in terms of how you see Mexicali Rose developing, or whether you see it taking on a different character in the future, whether it's more about pursuing the kind of work you're doing, women, and not getting too big, perhaps. You talked about being in the big leagues, but it's where does it go in the future?
I think what we're aiming for is just basically have it be full-time, because the time we all have to have our our day jobs in order to keep it running. So hopefully we'd be able to get enough funding, not necessarily through grants or government institutions, but just with the radio station, we've developed this sort of system where everybody pitches in. Sometimes people can't afford it, and obviously that's not going to be an issue with them continuing to be a part of the space, but just trying to get it to a point where we can be entirely self-sufficient and have it open 24 hours, well, not 24 hours, but most of the day, because a lot of kids, really, they have to adjust to our time schedule and they can't go visit the space at the times we want to grow, and we want the workshops to just basically be just there all the time, and sometimes we can't do that. And I really want more workshops. I think we've got a generation of kids that have been there since their junior high years, all the way up to college, and sort of influenced what they want to do with their lives after such a crucial stage, which I think is junior high and high school, and just sort of try to grow and our accessibility to the rest of the community. I think right now we're sort of bound to our work schedules, and hopefully we can get working to a point where that shouldn't be something that's sort of stopping us from growing.
Hi. So I think your presentation was really excellent. It doesn't really beg for questions, but I think the reality is that what's happening at Mexicali Rose, people are trying to do in a lot of different places. I just came from Alaska, doing a show up there for 3 weeks, and there's a space called Out There, and their population is totally underserved. There's no money. They're creating the same kind of thing that you're creating for populations. There's like all these migrants there, Hmong people, an incredible amount of different Latinos are up there in this incredibly hostile physical environment. They're doing a radio station also. I think the thing that's the most touching for me is that your city is not a place that's going to be getting gentrified anytime soon. So I think that that may not be really understood, you know, because the way we tend to think of places, you know, that this is a place that is beyond marginalized. You know, there's no possibility that you're going to become art stars. And you're in New York where people can only think in that context, that eventually something like this is going to happen, when really what you're doing is so much deeper in terms of social justice. And I really admire what you're doing. I'm like all about it. I'm really, really pleased to be here.
Thank you, thank you. I see a lot of tendencies actually in different art scenes in the different places with different independent spaces that we talk to. And I see a lot of tendencies to go towards more of this humanist sort of model. I think just the times of all style, no substance are kind of just, you know, things are so messed up, you don't really, you know, I think any artist is going through a hard time economically, that people are trying to build more relationships where, you know, money just sort of becomes more a communitarian thing. There's so many spaces like you mentioned, and I definitely think that I see that tendency. I see a lot of that in America, in South America. There's so many independent spaces like that. Just if you travel, you're gonna sort of bump into people that are like-minded, and you're gonna bump into those spaces as well. And I'm just very happy to see a lot of those spaces just happen to flourish in different cities. I'm glad that you mentioned the gentrification aspect, because we are actually trying our best to sort of battle that. As it now stands, they're trying to build a new border entry point through our community. Well, they are going to build it, and basically that's going to change the neighborhood entirely. It's more crime is going to go from the downtown area over to our area, and it's also going to be more police harassment. I think it's already happening, and it's also going to be a lot of these businesses that are international trade businesses, and that's sort of going to be the gentrification process that we foresee. So that's why we want to get a little stronger to just sort of be able to continue alive within that sort of context that's going to be changing our community. But I'm very honored that you're here as well. Thank you.
Hi. I just happened to be reading recently about Tim Rollins and KOS and looking at some of your work, and it just occurred to me, I haven't seen your show at the Artist Space, the other space, but I just wondered, was that ever a model for how you thought you might work with the kids in the community, or was that were all the projects generated by the kids themselves, and never sort of thought of a collaboration with you in the way that Tim Rollins collaborated with
kids? Well, there was several inspirations. I'm actually not familiar with the model. I think it's it was, like I mentioned, just a lot of different inspirations, like watching communities that have absolutely no money build their own schools, or watching people that are not in as media activists, not looking for any sort of monetary you know, response, just more of a human connection. And as far as inspiration, like even just the kids themselves coming in and seeing how, you'll see the films tomorrow and you'll see that it's like magic of somebody's first film. You know, you kind of don't get that back sometimes. And the first time you learn a craft, it's the most exciting time, I think. You're not gonna learn that you're a good filmmaker or a good guitar player or a good artist if somebody doesn't put those tools in your hand. And a lot of the time those instruments of expression are not really available to these communities. Yeah, I would say most of the time, yeah. For example, where Israel works, there's a lot of, it's just very expensive to be an artist at times. And also it's a very, sort of, there's a lot of workshops that I think are more like express workshops. If you pay $100 for 3 days of somebody telling you more about themselves than actually teaching you how to, you know, light something or, you know, grab the camera, you do it, I'm gonna do it for you. So there's a lot of also, like, I think it's just a lot of cheating in art in any place, you know. It's sort of like, I'm not gonna sort of blame institutions, but I think just a lot of people that use art as sort of like charlatans, you know, that just out to make money and not really make that much of a connection. And you see that with a lot of artists that were supposedly like street artists and now they're entirely commercial. And I think a lot of the kids that go to these spaces, they're not really looking to be art stars. They're just looking to build community and, you know, try to get respect from, you know, their peers and trying to be more creative. So they didn't really have those tools before.
Thanks. I was thinking actually about Richard's question about expanding and being larger, and I almost think it has, it maybe should be more directed towards artist space itself and how we value a practice like Mexicali Rose in relation to other like exhibitions and programming and our own financial structure and how we're so integrated into this like sort of different segment of the spectrum that is like the art world. And maybe actually Chris could talk a little bit about seeing Mexicali in relation to artist space and how it gets represented in New York.
Well, you know, I think an interesting thing is to just think about what's happened in New York, that we've lost all our spaces that are not connected to the art world, that the real estate and gentrification has created it so that none of the holes in the wall that created a lot of the art forms that are floating the art world right now exist anymore. And we can't have, like what you're talking about, what you're doing, and people are trying to do this in Harlem, and they're trying to do it in the Bronx. You can't do it on the Lower East Side anymore. And yet we have an enormous community of a constructed underclass that was created on purpose. The lack of education, which is being created on purpose. I mean, it's from the time that Chris and I were in the East Village, in the early 80s, it's a completely different world, what was possible then. So it is wonderful that an institution like Artist Space would host Mexicali Rose and then perhaps try to create some liaisons in our own city where we needed so much these same things. You know, and it's a little bit harder to do here because of the real estate situation. You want to talk about it?
What was Amy's comment?
Amy's comment was she said that she wanted you to talk about your experience of Mexicali Rose and bringing it here to you know, an established institution, art institution, like Artispace.
Thanks. It was, I met Marco the first time I went down because I was writing about another MLA art group who'd done a show there. And so I tapped the grant to do it, and I thought, okay, I'm really going to do the whole journalist thing and spend the travel budget on travel. And so I just went there. And there was an opening that weekend of the show Puro Personae, and I hadn't expected to really get into the work or, you know, think about that much. But the work was amazing. I mean, the first thing I was struck by was the mix of established artists, some of them like, you know, Mexico City people living in New York, people who'd been to art school, LA artists, and, you know, kind of professional artists from both sides of the border with these kind of street people and lunatics. I mean, like, what really blew me away was the desert rats from the U.S. side who seemed to be gravitating to the space because there's nothing for them there in Imperial Valley. It's one of the bleakest places in the United States. And so, like, you know, the high school art teacher from El Centro was there that night. And I thought this was extraordinary. I mean, I've never seen anything like it, that there could be this energy center and this magnet. You know, and fascinating, I think Sergio and others have pointed out, you know, one of the singular things about Mexicali, of the border cities, is that the energy is on the Mexican side. It's the big town, it's the city, and on the U.S. side, it's just these very kind of small podunk places. So it's the Mexican side that has the draw. And finally, Marco is kind of, you know, performing this. If nobody else funds Mexicali Rose, the INS should, because he's met kids in LA from Mexicali who wanted to come back to Mexicali on the strength of what he's doing there. So I thought this was just, you know, this was the most exciting thing I've ever seen, and the way that I could participate was to bring it here.
I just wanted to say something real quick to what she mentioned is, basically, I think there's also that misconception that just because it's something's in America, one of the projects that we have going is that we really want to workshop now in the Imperial Valley, which is the biggest unemployment rate in all the country. And there's so many stories there for those kids, and just because they're in America, you mentioned real estate is so tough. We saw all that in Los Angeles. A lot of these spaces were trying to get booted out. So many families got booted out too. And I just think that we all have our struggles, and I'm really glad to be in a place where everybody wants to get those struggles up solved. But I always laugh at that misconception that, oh, it's in the States, they're fine, but it's not the case at all.
Really mind what you're doing, and I just wanted to ask a question about the people, the kids that come to you. Is it mainly boys, or do you have girls? Because I've worked a little bit with girls in trouble here, and from what I've seen, you know, it's much harder. The girls have different issues, and there's a lot more of the kind of stuff that you offer in the States, I mean, I'm in LA, often for boys and for men, than for girls and for women, and I'm just wondering if you, what you had to say and what your experience about that was.
You know, we've always been conscious of that, and very much so after meeting Chris, too, she would always mention where's the girls, and it just kind of has been, recently we're pretty proud of it, of most of the documentaries that have been produced in the last year have been all women, all girls, and I don't think that they see themselves as sort of a more, with less opportunities, especially not at the space, so they've just been getting kind of closer. But at the beginning, we did have that problem where it was just mostly boys, and I think we just sort of continue working the same way and try to just appeal to everybody, how, you know, not be gender specific, and just we're very lucky that it has changed. I think, you know, some of the women that went there initially sort of spread the word, and now it's a lot more girls, and it's been growing that way. But yeah, we did have that problem initially, and I'm very glad that it's been changed. And Alicia is right here, she's one of our students, so she's videotaped, hard at work, videotaping.
Connected to that last question, I was interested in some pieces that show some kind of gay affirmation, and I wanted to ask you to talk a little more about that, and probably to Sergio too, in terms of like the social context of these pieces.
Yeah, we had a really amazing show, which Chris actually came back the second time, and she covered it for Art Forum, and it was a show called Todos Somos Putos, which is basically We're All Fags. And basically, it was just a group of friends that wanted to do an art show, which was very much trying to destroy that conventional sort of way of thought, the rainbow flag and, you know, the more flamboyant sort of a gay community. They were just, we are queer and we're artists. So they did a tremendous show, and it was very refined. I think a lot of people that went to see that show wanted to see your typical gay culture being represented, and they had these very sort of nostalgic, very interesting and beautiful pieces in the show. And I think it's a very Catholic city still. I'm very glad that we got to come here while the Pope was down there. it's basically, you know, I don't see it. My household, was never an issue with that. I've never had an issue. I don't see why it's ever been an issue, but definitely wanted to give that sort of space because they would have never, ever, ever been able to have that show anywhere else. And so we did it. It was just a tremendous show. It was a great coming together of different communities and people getting hipper to the space, you know, so this is a space where you can come and do your artwork without any sort of censorship. What was great about it is basically what I felt, I mean, it's a very sort of traditional city still, but at the same time, there's so many gay sort of underground clubs, and it's just the story of Mexico forever has been, you know, so many people go down there to have their sexual encounters, but it's still a very traditional part of the city. So there's always that, you know, border town especially, there's always that sort of double standard, you know. Now with all these casinos that are surfacing, you know, it's just, you know, come here and get your kicks, but you know, we're still pretty poor, you know. So that happens with the sexual culture or subculture as well. And we were just very excited to be able to lend this platform out to them because they were just trying to prove that point, whether it's in Mexico or in any other place in the world. You know, I think there's a cliche to what the culture is. So we were really excited to be able to sort of smash all those myths and present a very, very well refined show.
Yeah. Okay, could you mention a little bit about Hostel in relation to that space?
Yeah, there's a couple other spaces that are surfacing, which has been really great. And there's another space called Hostel, which is basically run by a group of art students. They're fresh out of school. And much more conceptual space, a smaller space. There's a lot of unfortunately, businesses just go broke, and there's an area in Mexicali, which is the civic center where all the government halls are, and they've been abandoned, and people are taking them over. Fernando and some other people did amazing work, basically got all this, it's like a little community you can walk through, you can't even drive in there, and they got a lift, they did like a three-story high murals, and I think people are trying to take that over and turn it into a more sort of bohemian, yeah, independent spaces. They sell, artists sell their stuff every Saturday. So I think it's the scene in that respect is growing, and I think it's very supportive. It's not, there's no cliques really. They've also been doing a lot of workshops too with the youth. And if you've seen the show, there's also, it's just like I mentioned, just doing stuff from scratch, but trying to get funds as well. There's a big mural that you saw on the show, the Mexicali mural, is all, materials that the factories didn't want anymore. So you give it a new use and you give your city a new identity using stuff that, you know, the factories don't want, and just gonna throw away and it's gonna become littered. But yeah, there's definitely a better scene of independent spaces growing up in Mexico.
I also have a question, and I came late, so I have to apologize in case you addressed that issue.
And obviously it's a very, very naive question, because I live here, I don't live there, but what is the security situation like when you do shows like this and when you are getting some visibility? Because here, from this perspective, one hears all these security issues. So I'm sorry, maybe you addressed it earlier. But I know the next panel addressed it that very specifically, in particular, but still.
I just think as far as the shows themselves go, we let anybody in. I saw some similarities in the show, like last night. There was a girl on the show last night. She was asleep on one of the tables. So we get stuff like that happening where we just let anybody in. Sometimes our shows are, we promote as much as we can, sometimes there's not that many people. Sometimes it's packed. There was one show where it was packed, where there was like a lot of gang members and, like I mentioned, members of the gay community, kids that, would never go to an institutional gallery. But we've never ever had any problems. There's never been any fights. There's never been, yes, people drink, people do whatever they can. We're not moralists, definitely not moralists, so people can do whatever they want. But I think they see the nature of the space and they've respected it. And we've had, just like anything, we've had people that go there and don't know what the space is about, probably won't ever understand what we're doing, and are very critical, and we, in a way we couldn't care less, but we take it into consideration because they are, this is great, why is this in such an ugly neighborhood? Stuff like that, and just trying to bring in something like a negative vibe, but it's always been very positive and haven't had much issues. If you're referring maybe to some of the content that we put out, and see if maybe we've had some sort of issues with censorship, we definitely have a lot of people that are curious about it. It's kind of funny, our front door neighbor is very religious, so sometimes we have like bands of punk bands come in and play at the radio station, and in front he's got a band full of nuns, which we kind of enjoy, but he never goes to any of the shows. You can tell the people around the neighborhood kind of keep an eye out to see what's going on, see if it really is positive. And it's funny because he never goes to any of the sort of regular shows. He went to the Todos Somos Putos, he went to the erotic shows, so it's just kind of like, we provided a little something for everybody, even though they don't want to admit that they like that kind of art. So. But there's never really any security issues. We're pretty sure it was one of our shows that was so packed, we were pretty sure there was people, that could have started problems, but they just see the vibe and they see everybody's having a good time, so never been a problem.
Okay, well, listen, we're just about out of time. Thank you very much, everyone, for participating. We'll take a short break. Okay. Sit down, please. Welcome to the second section of this. Thank you for joining us. I'll just wait till everybody's in the room before you go on break.
Any more chairs?
Yeah, okay. So, concurrently with working with Marta and others in Mexico to organize this exhibition, I was working in my capacity as semiotext on this book by Sergio Gonzalez Rodriguez over the last year and a half. It was very, very, it was a wonderful confluence of events, and it was very, very exciting to be put in touch with him by Ben Aaron-Mike. Ben Aaron-Mike's a good friend, one of my favorite writers, a novelist, and also an amazing journalist. And in 2009, Ben was in Mexico City researching a piece that he published the following year in that review of books, a long essay that many people consider to be the most kind of trenchant and comprehensive explanation of what's really behind the violence and the narco wars that's been published so far in England. While Ben was in Mexico, he met with Sergio Gonzalez Rodriguez, who of course by then was already well known for his work on the Juarez femicides. He published his book Bones in the Desert in 2002. And that was followed several years later in 2009 by the book Headless Man, which was a horrifying treatment of the power of symbolic violence. as being used by the narcotropic hunters. I mean, as I'm sure everyone knows who's read 266 and knows Bolaños, where Sergio González Rodriguez was the model for the journalist character in the third book, the part about the crimes, and Bolaños could never have written that part of the book without Sergio's work. They were closely in touch because Sergio was in Chihuahua most of the time documenting those crimes. Since that time, for various reasons, his focus on that subject has shifted from the purely specific and journalistic chronicling of events to looking at things on a more macro and theoretical level. So we were very lucky to be put in touch by Ben at a moment when Sergio was interested in doing a work that would be more synthetic and on a more theoretical level, trying to explain more clearly the systemic causes behind the violence in Juarez. And so that's what he's done in Genocide Machine, which has just come out this month from Semiotext. So I'm really honored and happy to present both of you for what's going to be a fascinating discussion. Another thing that you should know is that Sergio González Rodriguez, among his other work, is completing a doctorate in law right now in Mexico City. And if you read the book, you'll see that this question of the rule of law comes up over and over again, the absence of a rule of law in Mexico. In the book, he says that there's a 99% impunity for crimes committed in Mexico. And I think that's one of the things that they want to talk about, you know, the question of the rule of law from both the Mexican and the American perspective. I think Ben will have things to say about that. So thanks very much.
I will read a part of the introduction of my book, The Femicide Machine. In Ciudad Juarez, extraterritorial power normalized barbarism. This anomalous ecology mutated into a femicide machine, an apparatus that didn't just create the conditions for the murders of dozens of women and little girls, but developed the institutions that guaranteed impunity for those crimes and even legalizing them, a local city sponsored by state in crisis. The facts speak for themselves. Ciudad Juarez represents the kind of a human settlement that results from the destabilizing tensions of geopolitical interest. World order reveals its greatest contradiction here, there. Located in Mexican state of Chihuahua, Ciudad Juarez lies in the middle of the borderland that unites Mexico and the United States. An American vector of oil fields, natural gas, solar and wind energy exploitations, and first-class military bases and installations. The history of Ciudad Juarez evolved asynchronously. Bordering El Paso, Texas, the city has been subject to rapid modernization and industrialization process over the last 50 years, processes determined by economic and political power structure that oscillate between the formal and the informal, the legal and the illegal. This illegality allowed for the inclusion of organized crime within the city, accompanied in turn by its perverse effects, institutional corruption, and impunity for criminals. This development mode, a global, pragmatic production complex based on a depredation of the labor force in the name of the highest profit, unleashed intense population growth. Migrants arrived in Ciudad Juarez in search of work, and at the same time, local birth rates remained high. The immediate consequences of this growth were increasing poverty, marginalization, and scarcity quality of life. the city's cluster of institutions was incapable of providing satisfactory levels of housing, healthcare, safety, transportation, education, justice, culture, and environmental quality. Above all, they were unable to create a framework of respect for human rights. By placing the maquila, or assembly industry, at the center of the border model, Ciudad Juárez became a city machine whose attention entwined Mexico, the United States, the global economy, and the underworld of organized crime. These attentions were inscribed both in the overall operation of the city and in the concentric, ultra-contemporary terrain of its environment. The collective and personal tempo of Ciudad Juárez is linked to the simultaneous ubiquitous reach of the global economy and its information and communication technologies. The 1991 announcement of the North American Free Trade Agreement, NAFTA, between the United States, Mexico, and Canada would accelerate the city machine's functioning and its recharger iteration, the femicide machine. To understand the use of the compound term femicide machine as it relates to Ciudad Juárez, one must go beyond the simple metaphor of an industrial city. The femicide machine is inscribed within a particular structure of the neo-Fordist economy. In other words, it's a parasite. A parasite of this structure, just as the structure itself was encrusted upon the Mexican border. The structure is defined by mass economic regulation on an international macroeconomic scale and by assembly line production that differentiates products via flexible automated methods, information technology, and specially categorized labor. This economic setup presents a new complex interconnected spectrum of procedures for exploiting material and human resources, while at the same time maintaining more traditional mechanisms of exploitation. These procedures serve both tangible and intangible, and their ramifications are global. The femicide machine has characteristics that differ from the structure that supports it, and it also remains distinct from the state it inhabits. It derives strength from this autonomy, which makes finding it difficult because the machine tends to multiply or to transform in an expanded, specialized reproduction of itself. Ciudad Juárez's femicide machine can be better understood in light of a generic description of the ultra-contemporary machine. The machine is not limited to managing and straining entities closed off to one another, but opens up to other machines and together with them most mechanic assemblage. It consists of machines that penetrate several structures simultaneously. It depends on external elements in order to be able to exist at all. It is a generator that creates and directs non-linear aspects, potential dimensions, and unprecedented qualities. This mechanic integrity is complemented by the human individual group or collective element that devises it, keeps it running, and at some point can destroy it. It also maintains differentiated links and exchange with other machines, real and virtual. The war machine, the police machine, the criminal machine, or the machine of a political conformity. So that's why the femicide machine is composed of hatred and misogynistic violence, machismo, power, and patriarchal reaffirmation that take place at the margins of the law or within a law of complicity between criminals, police, military, government officials, and citizens who constitute an illegal all-boy network. Consequently, the machine enjoys discrete protection from individuals, groups, and institutions that in turn offer judicial and political impunity, as well as supremacy over the state and the law. Thank you very much.
Firmó un tratado de libre comercio con Estados Unidos y Canadá
encontrándose en una situación de absoluta contradicción asimétrica.
When Mexico signed the free trade agreement with the US and Canada, it was in a situation that was of absolute asymmetric contradiction.
Con el pretexto de la integración y la cooperación entre México y los vecinos del norte,
and with the pretext of integration and cooperation between Mexico and its neighbors to the north,
se pasaron por alto de los efectos que en la realidad iba a tener esta conjunción.
The effects that this conjunction would have in the real world were totally passed over.
Culturalmente nos encontramos con dos zonas geopolíticas absolutamente contradictorias.
Culturally, we are faced here with two geopolitical zones that are absolutely in contradiction.
Por un lado, a México se le exige estar a la altura de los países del norte.
On the one hand, it is demanded of Mexico to be at the same level as its more neighbors to the north.
Y por otro lado, se le considera un socio menor de edad o un socio que no tiene la capacidad de estar a la altura de los países del norte.
But on the other hand, it is considered seen as a kind of an underage neighbor, a neighbor that doesn't have the ability to be at the same level as the neighbors to the north.
Esta tendencia se une con la consideración de una serie de narrativas basadas en estereotipos de lo mexicano.
This tendency joins together with a number of narratives that are based on stereotypes about what's Mexican.
Por eso cuando suceden episodios de enorme tensión social, inestabilidad y violencia,
that's why when incidents of enormous social tension, stability and violence occur,
la percepción y la recepción de los problemas en Estados Unidos,
the perception and the reception of these problems in the United States,
suelen estar penetradas por estas narrativas falsas.
Tends to be penetrated by these false narratives.
Desgraciadamente para México, en Estados Unidos, México es el país de lo infernal.
Unfortunately for Mexico, in the US, Mexico is perceived as this country like hellish.
De la barbarie.
And barbaric.
De la posibilidad de la libertad, el libertinaje sin límites.
And a country that offers the possibility of limitless liberty behavior.
Infortunadamente, esto en etapas históricas llega a acontecer en la realidad.
Unfortunately, these kind of things do happen in reality at certain historic stages.
Pero no acontece porque sea una fatalidad histórica o un problema ontológico de los mexicanos.
But it doesn't happen because it's determined by a historical fatal tendency or because it's like an ontological problem of Mexicans.
Sino porque sus instituciones económicas, políticas y sociales están llenas de contradicciones.
It happens because its social, political and economic institutions are full of contradictions.
En el sentido de que las instituciones en México no tienen una solidez suficiente.
In the sense that Mexican institutions are just not solid enough.
Están sujetas a corrupción, a ineficacia, a negligencia.
They are subject to corruption, lack of efficiency, negligence.
En consecuencia, cíclicamente observamos estos episodios.
Consequently, we tend to see this kind of incidents or episodes in a cyclical way.
Donde México parece ser un país condenado a la premodernidad.
Where Mexico gives the impression of being a country that has been condemned to pre-modernity.
Yo encuentro la responsabilidad de esto en las clases dirigentes del país.
I personally find that the elite ruling classes of the country are the ones who are responsible for this.
Sobre todo porque la sociedad en México cada vez es más participativa, es un país de jóvenes.
Especially because Mexican society itself tends to be more open to participation recently, and it's like a young society.
Sin embargo, México es un país tremendamente desigual.
However, Mexico is an extremely unequal country.
Es un país desigual y además no ofrece posibilidades hacia el futuro a estos jóvenes.
It's a very unequal country who doesn't offer any chances for the future to these young people.
Es ahí donde el crimen organizado entra para ofrecer posibilidades que el Estado y los gobiernos no ofrecen.
That's where organized crime comes in to offer chances for the future that the state and the government seem not to be able to offer.
Explico esto porque de pronto parece ser que las narrativas basadas en estereotipos repugnan a una realidad.
And I'm explaining this because maybe in some instances these narratives based in stereotypes do seem to offer a connection to reality.
Sin embargo, en el fondo hay razones políticas, económicas y sociales que explican todas estas contradicciones.
However, in the very bottom, there's actually political, economic, and social reasons that do explain all these contradictions.
Mi visión y mi lectura de la realidad en México tiene que ver con el compromiso de explicar las cosas desde su profundidad.
So my vision, my reading of the Mexican reality has to do with a commitment to try to explain things from the very bottom of their essence.
Yo no reduzco la realidad a un tema de true crime, no terror.
I personally don't try to reduce reality to an issue of true crime, to the police pages.
Y yo trato de encontrar la multidimensionalidad de los fenómenos que estamos presenciando.
I try to find the many different dimensions in the phenomenon that we are seeing happening.
Yo no quiero considerar estos problemas graves como un asunto de buenos o malos, policías o ladrones.
I don't want to consider these very serious problems as problems reduced to good and bad, to police and robbers.
Por desgracia, la versión oficial, la versión gubernamental, tiende a reducir los hechos a este tipo de estereotipos.
Unfortunately, the official version, the version from the government, tends to reduce the incidents to these kind of versions.
La obligación como escritor, como periodista que tengo, es tratarle de dar al público mexicano y al público de Estados Unidos una explicación más enriquecedora.
My duty as a writer, as a journalist, is try to give to the audience or the readers in Mexico and the U.S. an explanation that is more enriching.
En esta explicación también participa el interés que ha surgido en la sociedad mexicana por retratar estos fenómenos a través del arte.
And this interest is also inflected by the interest that has come about in Mexican society to present or portray this phenomenon through art.
Estoy convencido que la cultura es un modo de contener a la barbarie.
And I am firmly convinced that culture is a way to put a protection against barbarism.
I open with that question mainly because I think the analysis that you presented in the Femicide Machine is so effective at disabling that narrative, and so effective at, I think, making clear the outlines of complicity that this country, both its government and its financial elites, have with the violence in Mexico. But before we get into that analysis in any more depth, I want to ask you a sort of more practical question, because you came to this as a reporter. You were writing for a reporter in Mexico City, you were sent up to the border, and began slowly to report on these puzzling and horrific murders beginning in the 1990s.
Entonces, debido al análisis que usted, creo que el análisis que usted hace en Femicide Machine es tan efectivo, tan eficiente para desarmar este tipo de narrativas y para dejar en claro la complicidad que tiene este país, tanto a nivel gubernamental como de élites económicas, respecto a la violencia en México. Yo quería comenzar con una pregunta un poco más práctica, que es el hecho de que usted se encontró inicialmente con este tema debido al trabajo como reportero, porque estaba trabajando para Reforma en Ciudad de México y llegado a la frontera a investigar lo que en ese momento eran delitos horrorosos y enigmáticos.
Así es.
And, you know, I assume many of you know this already, but more than 400 women were killed in Ciudad Juárez from the mid-90s into the 2000s. And as you're reporting on these, you know, these individual murders, can you sort of take us through the process where you went through, you know, from the experience of being a reporter, engaged with very empirical details, towards arriving at a much broader analysis, such as the one that you bring forth in the Femicide Machine.
Y entonces, esto fue algo probablemente la mayoría de gente sabe, pero más de 400 mujeres fueron asesinadas en Ciudad Juárez entre mediados de abril y mediados de los años 2000. Y entonces, yo quisiera que ustedes dos traten de dar un poco cómo fue que usted pasó de una coalición o un contacto con estos incidentes, que era más como el proceso técnico de recoger información como reportero, al proceso de hacer un análisis más profundo y más general como el que hace el presidente de Machine.
Yo empecé a investigar los asesinatos contra mujeres en Ciudad Juárez en el año de 1996.
I started investigating these killings against women in Ciudad Juárez in 1996.
Hacia el año 2000 sentí la necesidad de escribir un libro al respecto.
And towards the year 2000, I started feeling the need to write a book about it.
Cuando yo comencé a investigar estos hechos, sucedían simplemente como algo, como un acontecimiento de nota roja, de nota policial.
And when I started investigating these incidents, they were just incidents that were for the kind of pinch, like red page, the police blot.
La información se refería a estos homicidios como hechos más bien morbosos, amarillistas, sensacionalistas.
And basically the press was referring to these incidents, basically just trying to look for the scabrous details, for all the yellow press, all the scintillating kind of, you know, morbid thing.
La primera vez que yo fui a Ciudad Juárez, me enfrenté al drama del país.
So the first time I went to Ciudad Juárez, I had to face up to the drama happening in the country. The dramatic.
Una sociedad en la frontera con Estados Unidos que no tenía instituciones para realizar la ley ni ofrecer la justicia.
It was a society, a border town with the U.S. that had no institution to impose the rule of law to offer justice.
Recuerdo un episodio en particular en Ciudad Juárez. Cuando yo estaba en una rueda de prensa de las autoridades, se acercó a mí una señora de Ciudad Juárez con su hija.
And I remember specifically an incident that happened in Ciudad Juárez when I was at a press conference with the authorities, and a lady approached me along with her daughter in Ciudad Juárez.
Me querían entrevistar, hablar conmigo, mejor dicho, porque tenían algo que contarme.
They wanted to interview me, or rather, just to talk to me, because they had something to tell me.
Se sentían absolutamente indefensas estas mujeres.
They felt defenseless.
La mujer más joven, una chica de 14 años, me empezó a referir su experiencia con la policía.
So the youngest of them was a 14-year-old girl. Started talking, telling me what her experiences had been with the police.
Relató cómo un comandante de la policía de Ciudad Juárez la había tomado del cabello y golpeado contra una pared.
And he told me how a police commander in Ciudad Juárez had grabbed her by the hair and banged her head against a wall.
Lo que quería este policía es que esta muchacha declarara contra un ciudadano de Estados Unidos de origen árabe.
What this police commander wanted was for this girl to give a statement against a U.S. citizen of Arabic or Arab origin.
Esta persona había sido inculpada de asesinatos en serie.
This person had been charged for serial killings.
Después se comprobaría que las acusaciones eran falsas.
And it would later be proven to be false accusations.
Sin embargo, las acusaciones prosperaron y el ciudadano estadounidense de origen árabe.
However, these charges went ahead, and this U.S. citizen of Arab descent
fue condenado a muchos años de prisión.
Was
sentenced to many years in prison.
Abdel Latif Sharif Sharif es su nombre.
His name is Abdel Latif Sharif Sharif.
Esta persona, sin que hubiera acusaciones sólidas contra él, fue condenado a muchos años de cárcel.
This person was sentenced to many years in jail without really any solid foundation of accusations against him.
Años después, falleció en un penal de alta seguridad en Chihuahua.
Years later, he died at a maximum security prison in Chihuahua.
Las autoridades querían resolver estos homicidios inculpando a gente inocente.
The authorities wanted to solve, quote unquote, these murders, just charging innocent people.
Esta práctica se repitió una y otra vez a lo largo de los años.
And this kind of behavior happened time and time again with them as years went by.
La invención de culpables, la sospecha sobre familiares y amigos de las víctimas.
The made up guilty parties and the suspicion against relatives and friends of the victims.
La solución, entre comillas, de los asesinatos simplemente por una fantasía de los policías.
This way of quote unquote solving the crimes through just fantasy imaginings of the police.
Al paso de los años, las autoridades de Chihuahua incluso han negado la existencia de estos asesinatos contra mujeres.
As years have gone by, Chihuahua authorities have even denied the existence of these killings against women.
Desde la década de los noventas, alertamos varias personas que si no se solucionaban estos crímenes, hacia el futuro iba a ser un problema muy grave.
Since the 90s, we along with other people have alerted that if these crimes didn't get solved, it would become a much bigger problem in the future.
Por desgracia, lo que sucedió en Ciudad Juárez, con los años, ha sucedido ya en todo el país, en México.
And unfortunately, what happened in Ciudad Juárez, as years have gone by, has happened all around the country in Mexico.
Es un problema de instituciones corruptas e ineficientes.
It's a problem related to corrupt and inefficient institutions.
Cuando yo empecé a investigar estos homicidios, yo escribía estrictamente ensayos literarios o vinculados al arte o el cine.
When I started investigating these homicides, I would limit myself just to write literary essays or essays that had to do with art and film.
A partir de la investigación en sí, mi vida cambió radicalmente.
But through this investigation, my life changed completely.
A lo largo de los años, trabajé y fui a Ciudad Juárez siempre que fue posible o era necesario.
As years went by, I was going to Ciudad Juárez every time that it was possible or necessary.
En 1999 fui secuestrado, golpeado y torturado.
In 1999, I was kidnapped, beaten up and tortured.
Personajes vinculados a la policía querían disuadirme, a la policía de Chihuahua, querían disuadirme, convencerme de que ya no investigara este tema.
It was done by characters that were linked to the Chihuahua police who wanted to make me refrain from continuing the investigation on these issues.
Me secuestraron, me golpearon con cachas de las pistolas y me golpearon con picayelos en las piernas.
They kidnapped me and they hit me with the butt of their guns and with ice picks in my legs, on my legs.
Terminé en un hospital y salvé la vida de milagro.
I ended up in a hospital and I was alive just by a miracle.
Sin embargo, yo me siento muy afortunado.
However, I do feel very fortunate.
Porque muchos de mis compañeros en el trabajo periodístico no tuvieron la misma suerte que yo.
Because many colleagues, other journalists, weren't as lucky as me.
En los últimos 10 años en México, más de 70 periodistas han sido asesinados y desaparecidos en el cumplimiento de su trabajo.
In the last 10 years, more than 70 journalists have been killed and disappeared while engaged in their duties.
en honor de mis compañeros muertos en su trabajo, yo quisiera solicitar a ustedes un aplauso en su memoria.
And to honor these colleagues of mine killed in the line of duty, so to speak, I would like to request that you make a round of applause.
La experiencia con lo más extremo, desde luego que obliga a un esfuerzo como periodista y como escritor.
Obviously, this experience of the most extreme kind do force you to make a real effort as a journalist and a writer.
De ahí mi compromiso, mi interés de tratar de realizar una mejor lectura de los hechos.
That's where my commitment, my interest to provide a better reading of the incidents comes from.
Encontrar una forma de hablar de esto que incluya el punto de vista geopolítico tanto como el aspecto criminal.
Try to find a way of speaking about it that would include both the geopolitical aspect as well as the criminal aspect itself.
Pero también incluir los factores económicos, políticos, sociales y culturales que hay de por medio.
And try to include all the economic, political, social, and cultural aspects that are in the midst of all this.
Las situaciones más extremas tienen que obligarnos a un ejercicio extremo también de imaginación y de capacidad intelectual.
The most extreme circumstances should also force us to come up with the most extreme efforts in terms of imagination and intellect.
Es lo menos que podemos hacer en nombre de las víctimas de todos estos que han fallecido.
It's the least we can do in the name of the victims and all the people that have been killed.
As Chris mentioned, we first met when I was in Mexico City working on an assignment to write an essay about what we call the drug violence in Mexico, and trying really hard to figure out what was going on. And to my surprise, the work that began to make sense for me of this extremely senseless violence was not about the violence of the mid to late 2000s, but was your book about the murders of women whites.
Como yo Chris nos conocimos de Ciudad de México cuando yo estaba tratando de cubrir una obligación de reportero para hacer reportaje de la violencia extrema en México. Curiosamente, y lo que me sorprendió es que cuando estaba tratando de darle sentido a toda esta violencia extrema y a partir de ese sentido, todo comenzó a cobrar forma no tanto relacionado con la violencia de la segunda mitad de los 2000, sino más bien la lectura de libros sobre la violencia anterior, la violencia contra mujeres.
Which the book, which unfortunately is not available in English, is called The Bones of the Desert, which is the Cerro del Monte, in English and Spanish. I was going to encourage you to seek it out. But that seemed to describe better than anything else I could find a situation of societal collapse and institutional collapse, which you described in Ciudad Juarez, which soon became generalized. Not entirely, but began to spread to other parts of Mexico, the entire country. And I wonder if you could begin to describe how you saw that begin to, what was happening in a nascent form in Juarez begin to spread to the rest of the country.
Y entonces, esto está relatado en un libro que se llama Huesos en el Desierto, que generalmente no está traducido en inglés. Y es un libro que describe mejor que ningún otro la situación de colapso institucional en el país. Y cómo es algo que comenzó ocurriendo en Ciudad Juárez y después se ha generalizado casi por completo en muchas otras partes de México. Entonces quisiera que usted nos cuente cómo es que usted vio que se comenzaba a extender este fenómeno de colapso institucional que inicialmente había visto en Ciudad Juárez.
If I may add, what was most interesting was it made it possible to think about what are called the drug wars as not having very much to do with drugs at all.
Y entonces también es algo que permitía pensar en lo que se llama a como la guerra.
Así es, creo que el elemento a distinguir es muy interesante de observar porque puede repetirse mañana en cualquier parte.
Yes, that's right, and I think the element that should be pointed out, and it's very interesting to see, It's that way because it's actually something that could be repeated anywhere tomorrow.
Si las instituciones permiten que en algún momento la situación adversa rebase a las propias instituciones, hay una bomba de tiempo hacia el futuro.
If the institutions allow at any time any adverse situation to basically overpower them completely, you have a ticking time bomb.
Fundamentalmente, los homicidios de mujeres en Ciudad Juárez están directamente vinculados al narcotráfico y al poder del narcotráfico que corrompe también instituciones y capital privado.
And fundamentally, this killing of women in Ciudad Juárez is directly linked to drug trafficking and to the power of drug trafficking to corrupt both institution and private capital.
Hay que pensar en el narcotráfico como un fenómeno que va más allá de unos traficantes de droga llevando droga de aquí para allá.
And you have to think of narcotrafficking as a phenomenon that goes beyond just some guys trafficking in drugs and carrying drugs from one place to another.
Debido a la enorme cantidad de dinero que generan estas actividades,
because of the huge monetary amounts that this kind of activity generate,
considerando, por ejemplo, que la sociedad norteamericana es el mayor consumidor, es la mayor consumidora de drogas en todo el mundo,
in taking into account the fact, for example, that the U.S. society is actually the biggest consumer of drugs in the entire world,
estamos comprendiendo el problema como un asunto económico y político.
You have to understand this phenomenon as an economic and political problem,
que después va a impactar en la sociedad y la cultura,
which later on would have an impact in society and in culture.
El narcotráfico implica, sobre todo, otras industrias criminales.
And what narcotrafficking implies or brings is especially other kind of criminal enterprises.
Por ejemplo, el lavado de dinero, el secuestro, la extorsión, el robo.
For example, money laundering, kidnapping, extortion, robberies.
Explotación de personas.
Exploitation of people.
Explotación sexual de niños, menores, mujeres y hombres.
Sexual exploitation of kids, of underage people, either women or male.
Un conjunto de actividades criminales que van llevando consigo una enorme cantidad de dinero.
A conjunction or a group of criminal activities that carry together just an enormous amount of money.
Cuando en Ciudad Juárez comenzaron a darse estos fenómenos, las instituciones no atendieron debidamente el problema.
When this kind of phenomenon started happening in Ciudad Juárez, the institution didn't give the problems the needed attention.
De hecho, la corrupción fue tan grande que las autoridades locales fueron completamente atrapadas por el crimen organizado.
And in fact, the corruption was so big that the local authorities were completely taken over by organized crime.
Por desgracia, y aquí llego a la pregunta que hacía Ben.
And unfortunately, and I'm now heading to what was Ben's question.
El fenómeno se propagó porque las instituciones federales, el gobierno federal de México, no atendió tampoco este problema.
And unfortunately, this phenomenon spread throughout because the federal institution, the central Mexican government institutions, didn't put the necessary attention to these problems.
De ahí que lo que fue un problema local se convertiría con el tiempo en un problema nacional.
And otherwise, what had been a local problem became, as time went by, a completely national problem.
Nadie, entre muchos de los voceros oficiales, quiere recordar esto ahora.
Nobody among the many official speakers wants to remember about this right now.
Pero ahí está una de las causas más claras de interpretar.
But one of the clearest causes to interpret this phenomenon lies in that issue.
Cuando yo investigué estos homicidios contra mujeres en Ciudad Juárez,
when I started investigating these killings against women in Ciudad Juárez,
traté de encontrar los elementos de este drama
I tried to find out what the elements of this dramatic situation were.
Y sobre todo seguir puntualmente su proceso a lo largo del tiempo.
And especially just to follow the thread with a lot of detail throughout the passing of time.
Por eso es que ahora cuando recuperamos el tema de los homicidios contra mujeres en Ciudad Juárez, el femicidio.
So now when we go back to the issue of the homicides against women in Ciudad Juárez, this femicide.
Podemos entender también el drama de todo el país.
We can also understand the national drama.
¿Por qué? Porque lo más importante para entender esto se llama memoria.
Because the most important thing to try to understand this is what we call our memory.
México es un país sin memoria.
Mexico is a memoryless country.
Por eso es tan importante investigar y hacer constar las voces, sobre todo las voces de las víctimas.
That is why it is so important to investigate and to create a record of the voices, particularly the voices of the victims.
En mis investigaciones me aniquiló un episodio que ahora voy a referir.
And during my investigation there was a specific episode that just overwhelmed me and really shattered me, and I'm going to tell you right now.
En 2001 una muchacha fue secuestrada en Ciudad Juárez.
There was a young woman who was kidnapped in Ciudad Juárez in 2001.
De acuerdo con testimonios de los testigos, la muchacha gritaba, auxilio, auxilio, ayúdenme.
And according to eyewitness testimony, this young woman was screaming, help, help, somebody help me.
Nadie acudió en su ayuda.
And nobody did.
Su cuerpo fue encontrado una semana después, obviamente ya era un cadáver con signos de estrangulamiento.
Her body was found a week later, obviously was found with marks of strangulation.
Había sido torturada, mutilada, violada.
She had been tortured and mutilated and raped.
Y su cuerpo terminó en un baldío como basura.
And her body ended in an empty lot as if it were garbage.
La familia investigó este caso por su parte porque las autoridades no quisieron hacerlo.
And the family had to investigate this crime privately because the authorities didn't want to do it.
Obtuvieron información acerca de quiénes eran los presuntos culpables.
And they obtained information about who were the supposed culprits.
Eran narcotraficantes que las autoridades no quisieron tocar.
And there were drug traffickers that the authorities were reluctant to touch.
Todavía ahora el grito de esta muchacha que nadie escuchó me sigue quitando el sueño.
And in my particular case, the screams of this young woman who nobody cared about still make me sleepless.
La vida reducida a un grito que nadie escucha.
Her life reduced to a scream that nobody wanted to listen.
Por eso la memoria de ese grito es uno de mis compromisos hacia el futuro también.
That's why to keep the memory of that scream alive is one of my commitments to the future.
You hinted this in the section of the introduction that you read, but if we talk a little bit more about what makes Ciudad Juárez special. The violence in Mexico has become generalized, but it's not everywhere. There are parts of the country which are completely peaceful. The murders of women have not spread everywhere. In the book, you talk about Juárez as the ultra-capitalist city, and as elsewhere, right, that the world order reveals its greatest contradictions there. Can you talk a bit about that?
Pues porque estoy hablando un poco más de algunas cosas que surgió en el pasaje que le dio la introducción, que es qué es lo que hace que Ciudad Juárez sea tan particular, porque digamos, a pesar de que hay los asesinatos generalizados en todo el país, tampoco es algo que se ha distribuido a todas partes. Y en la introducción usted habla de Ciudad Juárez como este lugar del ultracapitalismo, como este lugar donde el orden global muestra sus contradicciones más profundas. No sé si puede hablar un poco más sobre esto.
Correcto. Ciudad Juárez acaba de declararlo hace un par de días el subsecretario de Estado de Estados Unidos.
Ciudad Juárez, this is something that the Undersecretary of State of the U.S. declared a couple days ago.
Que Ciudad Juárez es la ciudad más violenta de México y del hemisferio.
That Ciudad Juárez is the most violent city in Mexico and in the whole hemisphere.
Y y probablemente de todo el mundo, dijo.
Probably the entire world, that's what he said.
Lo que no mencionó es la corresponsabilidad de Estados Unidos al respecto.
What this person didn't mention was the joint responsibility of the U.S. In that.
Para que Ciudad Juárez llegara a esta situación, hay por lo menos dos factores primordiales.
For Ciudad Juárez to get to this situation, there's at least two main factors.
Históricamente, Ciudad Juárez ha sido una ciudad vinculada al crimen y a la explotación de las personas.
Historically, Ciudad Juárez has always been a city that has been linked to crime and to exploitation of people.
En esta situación hay una corresponsabilidad de Estados Unidos.
And there's a joint responsibility of the U.S. in that situation.
Ya que tradicionalmente Ciudad Juárez ha sido el traspatio de Estados Unidos.
Since traditionally Ciudad Juárez has been like the U.S. backyard.
De ahí que tengamos crimen, explotación de personas, no solamente por el turismo sexual, sino sobre todo por la industria ensambladora.
And that's the reason why we have crime and exploitation of people, not only because sexual tourism, but mostly because of the assembly line industry.
Tradicionalmente, Ciudad Juárez también ha sido un punto a lo largo de las décadas muy importante para el contrabando de mercancías y productos y también de personas.
And traditionally, Ciudad Juárez has been a key spot throughout many decades for contraband, both of merchandise and products and people.
Estas actividades generan mucho dinero y por lo tanto mucha codicia.
These kind of activities generate a lot of money and therefore a lot of greed.
Autoridades que se corrompen.
Authorities get corrupted.
Gente de poder que se vuelve socia de los narcotraficantes u otros delincuentes.
People in positions of power that became partners with narcotraffickers and other criminals.
Una precariedad institucional que lleva muchos años funcionando allá.
A precariousness of institutions that had been the same way for many years down there.
Como afirmaba un funcionario mexicano de área de seguridad, Ciudad Juárez es un ecosistema criminal.
As a Mexican official of the security of security issues would say, Ciudad Juárez is like a criminal ecosystem.
Esto es lo que opina este funcionario. Pero también omite decir la responsabilidad de las autoridades mexicanas para sostener y mantener este ecosistema de crimen.
But that's his official opinion, but he fails to mention the responsibility of Mexican authorities to support and sustain this criminal ecosystem.
Por desgracia, lo que ha sucedido en Ciudad Juárez ya acontece en otras partes del país, por ejemplo, el problema del femicidio.
Unfortunately, what has been happening in Ciudad Juárez is now happening in other parts of the country, for example, this issue of femicide.
El Estado de México es un estado con una enorme violencia contra las mujeres.
For example, Mexico State is a state that has an enormous amount of violence against women.
Y quiero mencionar que muchos de estos crímenes permanecen impunes, como en Ciudad Juárez.
And I have to mention that many of these crimes stay in impunity the same way as it happened in Ciudad Juárez.
Así como no se resolvieron, no se castigó ni se detuvo a los culpables de estos asesinatos contra mujeres en Ciudad Juárez.
The same way that this killing of women in Ciudad Juárez were never solved and the culprits were never found or punished.
El problema se volvió muy grave en todo el país.
The similar problem became very serious throughout the country.
Me refiero al problema de la impunidad.
And what I'm referring specifically here is impunity.
En México, el 98% de los delitos no son castigados.
In Mexico, 98% of crimes never get punished.
Esto nos da una idea de que estamos en una crisis profunda del Estado.
And that suggests the idea that we are facing a profound crisis in the state.
Es una sociedad colapsada, por lo tanto.
It's therefore a society that has collapsed.
Y encontramos en la explicación histórica de estos hechos la explicación de nuestro presente.
And we find in the historic explanation of these facts an explanation also for our present.
En ausencia de un Estado de Derecho y en ausencia del imperio de la ley, no es posible tener una sociedad moderna ni democrática.
If you don't have a rule of law, you cannot have a democratic modern society.
Los problemas se acumulan día tras día.
And problems pile up day after day.
Y las autoridades cierran los ojos o quieren cerrar los ojos contra ellos.
And authorities keep their eyes closed, maybe willfully, against all this.
Las autoridades tienden a desacreditar a sus críticos.
And the authorities tend to try to discredit their critics.
Tienden a culpar a los críticos de haber exagerado y creado una mala imagen de Ciudad Juárez y del país.
They intend to blame critics for exaggerating and for creating or giving Ciudad Juárez and the country a bad image.
Recuerdo que hace unos años vine a presentar mi libro Huesos en el Desierto.
I remember that years back I came to present my book, Bones in the Desert.
Y el cónsul de México en Estados Unidos quiso impedir la presentación de mi libro.
And the Mexican consul in the U.S. tried to not allow the presentation of this book.
Decía, no podemos permitir que venga este señor a hablar mal de México.
And his words were, we cannot allow this gentleman to come here and speak badly about Mexico.
Bueno, para mi infortunio, este funcionario es ahora el embajador de México en Estados Unidos.
And unfortunately for me, this gentleman is now the Mexican ambassador in the U.S.
No quiero yo personalizar, pero sí ejemplifico cuál es la actitud de los funcionarios ante el problema de la violencia en México.
And I don't want this to make it like a personal thing, but just to offer that as an example of the attitude of government officials about violence in Mexico.
Finalmente, los periodistas, los críticos, lo que hacemos es tratar de recordar los preceptos, los principios de la Constitución de México.
Because in the end, I mean, journalists and critics, what we do is try to remind them of the disposition and the principles that guide the Mexican Constitution.
Que son básicamente, o en abstracto, los mismos de la Constitución de Estados Unidos.
Which are, in the fundamental abstract terms, the same that guide the U.S. Constitution.
Me recuerdo, sobre todo, me recuerdo, aludo, a lo que es la defensa del Estado y el imperio de la ley.
And what I'm remembering, what I'm trying to allude to, is just a defense of a state guided by the rule of law.
Finalmente es lo que pedimos, el cumplimiento estricto de los principios constitucionales y de la ley.
Finally, that's what we're asking for, a strict enforcement of constitutional principles and the rule of law.
Tenemos que encontrar allí un modo de resolver la situación hacia el futuro.
Because that's where we need to find a way to solve the situation in terms of the future.
I have three more pages of questions for you. Unfortunately, I think we finally have time for me to ask one, and then we'll turn it over to the audience. And hopefully you guys will intuit the questions I was going to ask. But another question about something that is perhaps obvious that we haven't touched on, which is this book is called the Femicide Machine and not the Homicide Machine. These were murders of women. This was a very gendered violence that was, in every case, accompanied by extreme forms of sexual violence. How do you understand that, and how do you understand that in relationship, you know, if we're understanding the murders of women in Juarez as a kind of beginning of the violence that was later generalized, what does it mean that in the beginning it was acted on the bodies of women?
Entonces, otra cosa que es bastante obvia, pero que cabe mencionar, es que usted ha hablado de funcionamiento sobre la máquina de homicidio. Entonces, estos eran delitos, asesinatos contra mujeres, que venían acompañados con frecuencia de una extrema violencia sexual, y no eran simplemente asesinatos generales, sino algo que tenía especificidad de género. Entonces, ¿cómo es que usted lee este hecho, si es que está dando alguna lectura respecto a esto como el comienzo de una violencia que luego se generalizó en todo el país?
Yo lo que encuentro es el problema de la impunidad. Sin castigo, los criminales ven el libertinaje abierto a sus deseos.
Well, what I find here is basically just impunity, the fact that without, with lack of punishment, the criminals see an open way to impose their desires.
En impunidad o bajo la impunidad, los criminales crean todo tipo de fantasías que por desgracia realizan.
Under a regimen of impunity, these criminals can come up with all kinds of fantasies in their heads that unfortunately they be able to carry out.
Gran parte de estos homicidios fueron cometidos contra mujeres jóvenes o niñas.
A lot of these homicides were committed against women that were either young or still children.
Obviamente, aquí hay un asunto de poder masculino muy arraigado.
And obviously, this has to do with a deep-seated issue related to masculine power.
En testimonio de un criminal que tuvo acceso a este tipo de delitos.
In the testimony of a criminal who had access to these kind of crimes.
Secuestraban, violaban y asesinaban mujeres jóvenes porque estaban nuevas, eran nuevecitas.
He said that they would kidnap, rape and murder young women because they were brand new, they were still brand new.
Aquí tenemos muy claramente referida la idea de un dominio sin ningún límite, un dominio masculino.
And this refers clearly to the idea of a masculine dominion.
Que configuró con el tiempo una auténtica fraternidad masculina del crimen.
Which, as time went by, really made up like a real masculine brotherhood in crime.
Poder, impunidad, fantasías desmedidas, libertinaje sin límites.
Power, impunity, limitless fantasies and limitless libertine behavior.
Ese fantasma y la realidad que está permanentemente en la sociedad mexicana.
Is both a ghost underneath and also just a palpable reality in Mexican society.
Afortunadamente, en los últimos años ha habido diversas reformas de ley para combatir el delito de feminicidio.
Fortunately, in the last few years, there have been numerous reforms to the law to try to strike against this crime of femicide.
Sin embargo, sabemos por experiencia en todas partes que ni más leyes ni más penas van a contener el crimen en sí por sí.
Unfortunately, we know from experience everywhere that just more laws or more punishment are not really going to contain crime in itself.
No bastan más leyes ni más penas.
More laws or more punishment are not enough.
Es necesario avanzar mucho en información, educación y cultura.
It is necessary to make inroads, big inroads in terms of information, culture and education.
En restaurar un Estado de Derecho y el imperio de la ley.
Try to restore the rule of law and the respect for human rights.
Y en crear una cultura de la legalidad.
And try to create a culture of legality.
En ausencia de estos asuntos,
in absent these factors,
vamos a seguir teniendo entre Estados Unidos, Canadá y México enormes asimetrías.
We will still have, absent these factors, we will still have huge asymmetries between the U.S. and Mexico and Canada.
Nuestra obligación es presentar lo más imparcialmente posible una situación que por desgracia es muy adversa.
And our duty is try to present in the most impartial way, a situation that is unfortunately very adverse.
Solo con un buen diagnóstico de la realidad,
only a good diagnosis of reality,
podremos proponer soluciones hacia el presente y el futuro.
Would allow us to propose solutions for the present and towards the future.
Ese es nuestro compromiso. No tenemos otra alternativa.
That's the commitment that we have made because we have no other choice.
Tenemos que continuar en esta tarea porque es algo que le debemos a las víctimas.
We have to continue on this work because it's something that we owe to the victims.
Y es algo que nos reclamarán en el futuro las nuevas generaciones si no lo hacemos.
And it's something that future generations would
nuestra capacidad.
It's something that future generations would look towards us, or no, would complain to us if we don't do.
Nuestra capacidad de estudio y investigación,
our ability to study and to investigate,
tiene que tener muy claramente estos objetivos.
We have to keep focus on these objectives.
En nuestra apuesta, pues, hacia el futuro.
It's a bet that we are doing for our future.
I hope you'll join me in applauding.
Crime started to take place on a local level, but was not combated and hence spread all over the country. Do you think, given the enormous forces involved, that it would have been preventable?
Sí, definitivamente con mejores instituciones, castigo a la impunidad y cumplimiento de la ley se hubiera evitado este problema.
Yes, in fact, if the institutions had worked better, if there had been punishment and no impunity and the application of the rule of law, you would have prevented this problem.
Cada vez que no se castiga un crimen, es una oportunidad para los criminales.
Every time a crime goes unpunished, that gives the criminals an opportunity.
Prima, quiero decir que es un gran honor sentir tu hablando propio aquí. First, I want to say it's a great honor that he's here and we're hearing him speak. Yo lo digo en inglés porque es más rápido. the title of your book, The Femicide Machine, esta máquina, ¿no? It functioned because it was successful. My understanding of what was going on there was that it was a much more sophisticated system than just a serial murder. The women were found sometimes 7-8 months later, their bodies had been refrigerated. It was a complete cahoots with the government and with the police. And then this is also spread to Laredo, isn't that true?
Entonces, el título de su libro, El femicidio, la máquina de femicidio, implica que esta máquina funciona porque tiene éxito. Lo que yo tengo entendido respecto a lo que ocurrió es que es un sistema mucho más sofisticado que si simplemente fue un asesino serial, porque a veces los cuerpos se encontraban 7-8 meses después, a veces habían sido refrigerados y había casi como un complot completo entre el gobierno y la policía, y después fue algo que también se extendió a Laredo.
En efecto, es un asunto que rebasa la conceptualización de un asesino en serie cometiendo esto.
Yes, it's true. I mean, it's a situation that completely goes beyond the idea you could have just as a single serial killer doing this.
Quiero citar el diagnóstico que hizo el criminólogo estadounidense Robert Ressler.
And I want to quote from the diagnosis offered by American criminologist Robert Ressler.
¿Por qué lo cito a Ressler? Porque él es el creador del concepto asesino en serie y asesinatos en serie.
I am quoting Ressler because he's the person who created the concepts of serial killer and serial killings.
Ressler estuvo en Ciudad Juárez invitado por las autoridades de Chihuahua a hacer una un diagnóstico de la situación hacia la década de los 90.
And Ressler was invited by the Chihuahua authorities to Juarez, who offered a diagnosis of the situation that happened during the 90s.
Su visita lo llevó más bien a la decepción, puesto que no tuvo la ayuda que él esperaba.
And his visit was a disappointment for him because he didn't receive the help he was expecting.
Ya de regreso en Estados Unidos declaró lo siguiente.
And when he was back in the U.S., he gave the following statement.
Hasta donde él había podido investigar los hechos y los expedientes que le pudieron mostrar o que le quisieron mostrar.
And he said that to the extent that he had been able to investigate the facts and based on the files of information that he was either they were able to show him or just willing to show him.
Detectó entre dos y tres bandas de criminales dedicados a secuestrar, torturar y asesinar mujeres.
He could realize that there were at least two or three different criminal groups that were devoted to the kidnapping, torturing, and killing of women.
Perfiló también que se trataba de personas que tenían tránsito entre Estados Unidos y México.
He also offered the profile, saying that these were people that had the ability to go between the U.S. and Mexico.
Que eran personas con enorme poder de dinero, de comunicación, de complicidad con las autoridades, etc.
And that these were people who had big economic power and the ability to establish communication and to have complicity from authorities.
Llamó a estos asesinatos, asesinatos de juerga, spree murders.
And he called these killings spree killings, related to the idea of having fun, like a joyride killing.
Estos sujetos salían, no salen, porque aún hay muchos casos similares y desaparición de niñas y menores actualmente en Ciudad Juárez, mediante un modus operandi muy específico.
And these people would go in their sprees and still go because there's still cases of killings of underage and women and children in Juarez. They would have a very specific modus operandi.
Es una operación compleja.
It was a complex operation.
Que empieza desde la detección de las víctimas.
That started with choosing the victims.
Por ejemplo, acuden o tienen acceso a expedientes de las industrias que contratan obreras.
For example, they have access to the file of the industry that are hiring factory workers.
Y van seleccionando las víctimas.
And they start choosing the victims that way.
Investigan dónde viven, cuál es su rutina diaria, etc.
They investigate where these people live, where what is their daily routine, etc.
Y en un momento dado, ven a la víctima en la calle, la secuestran y no se vuelve a saber de ella.
So, at some specific point, they see the victim out in the street, they kidnap the victim, and you won't hear about this victim again.
Este conjunto de anomalías institucionales y de, por desgracia, habilidades criminales es lo que denominamos la máquina femicida.
So, this conjunction, this coming together of the anomaly of the institutions and unfortunately the ability of the criminals is what you would call the feminist machine.
Y además la relación que tiene esta máquina de asesinar mujeres con el contexto económico de la propia ciudad.
And also the relationship of this women killing machine with the economic context of the city.
Las industrias maquiladoras de la frontera prácticamente no se hacen responsables de la seguridad de sus empleados ni de nada.
The maquiladora factories on the border basically don't feel responsible, don't make themselves responsible for the safety of the employees or for anything else for that matter.
En Ciudad Juárez, los habitantes de Ciudad Juárez dependen de su propia vida, de su propia capacidad de defenderse y de cuestionar a las autoridades.
The inhabitants of Ciudad Juárez depend for their lives on their own ability to defend themselves and to question authority.
De allí que, por ejemplo, hayan surgido a últimas fechas las alternativas de emplear el arte y la cultura para combatir la violencia.
That's the reason why lately there's been the alternative of trying to use art and culture to fight against violence.
Yeah, I have one other little question. So I'm going to say it in English, and that is that there was some idea for a while that these murders of these women were being done systematically by the drug cartels to control the politicians. Is that not believed anymore?
Hubo, es una pregunta breve. En cierta época se sostuvo la idea por un tiempo de que estos asesinatos de mujeres eran algo que los cárteles de droga estaban haciendo de manera sistemática para mantener el control sobre los políticos. ¿Es esa una idea que todavía sea creíble o no, según usted?
El crimen organizado emplea los cuerpos de las mujeres de muchos modos.
Well, organized crime uses the body of these women in many different ways.
Durante una etapa, que es la que se menciona ahora, los cuerpos de las mujeres se empleaban como mensajes a las autoridades.
There was a certain time, certain stage, you are alluding right now, in which the bodies of these women were used as messages to the authorities.
Mensajes para coaccionar a las autoridades, para extorsionarlas.
Messages that had the intention of coacting, putting pressure, extorting the authorities.
Por ejemplo, en el año de 2001 hubo un acontecimiento tremendamente trágico que fue el hallazgo de 8 cuerpos de mujeres en un campo de algodón en las afueras de Ciudad Juárez.
For example, in 2001 there was a tragic incident where 8 bodies of women were found in a cotton producing field in the outskirts of Juárez.
De acuerdo con el jefe de servicios periciales en ese momento,
and according to the chief of forensic services at the time,
los cuerpos pertenecían a diversas etapas de haber sido asesinados.
The bodies had been killed at different times.
Algunos cuerpos tenían signos, señales de haber estado refrigerados.
And some bodies would give the impression of having been refrigerated.
Y un día fueron sacados y puestos con otros cuerpos en un enterramiento dirigido a coaccionar a las autoridades.
And at some point had been taken out of refrigerator and dumped with other bodies in a burial that had the intention of basically putting pressure on authorities.
Esto habla de la enorme malicia criminal de estos sujetos.
And that obviously speaks volumes about the criminal malice of these individuals.
Durante un tiempo se vio este tipo de usos, pero de pronto los cuerpos ya no aparecieron en la vía pública.
So that usage was sustained for a certain amount of time, but then suddenly later on, bodies stopped showing up on just the streets.
De acuerdo con testimonios de una fuente del FBI,
and according to the testimony of an FBI source,
en una etapa posterior, los cuerpos fueron desaparecidos ya.
At a later stage, the bodies were made to disappear.
Por ejemplo, fueron echados a criaderos de cerdos para que devoraran los cuerpos.
For example, they would be dumped in a pig factory so that they would be eaten.
Este tipo de usos han cambiado con el tiempo. Hace unos 3 meses apareció de nuevo otro cuerpo arrojado como en los años anteriores.
And these uses of the bodies had changed as time went by. For example, about 3 months ago, there was another body that was just laying out in plain view as it had been in the past.
También se ha encontrado cuerpos vinculados a quizás algunos usos rituales de los narcotraficantes.
There is also bodies that have been found that maybe had some link to some ritual use on the part of the narcotraffickers.
O bien los cuerpos son tatuados o mutilados con ciertas señales para dejar constancia de estos crímenes.
Or the bodies are either tattooed or mutilated in a certain specific way with certain signs that provide a record of the crime.
En testimonio también de una fuente del FBI,
there's the witness, the testimony of another FBI source.
Estos homicidios no han sido investigados por el gobierno mexicano. Cuando se trata, como dice esta fuente, de narcotraficantes, gente de poder y criminales.
Oh, sorry, that was a mistranslation. So it's something that has to do with drug traffickers and people in position of power and authorities.
Lo que da una idea muy claramente del problema, no se ha atacado suficientemente bien.
So that gives you a clear understanding of what the problem is, that there's no really been any efficient attack on it.
Por desgracia, el FBI no puede intervenir en México.
And unfortunately, the FBI have no power to really intervene in Mexico.
Y las autoridades mexicanas han callado al respecto.
And the Mexican authorities have stayed silent on this.
Another question.
Yeah, you talked about very incredibly cruel practices, right? Some of them have been used in the States, you know, among traffickers. You find bodies that are left killed in some position as a message to those who didn't pay for drugs, for instance. What is interesting is that you have some sort of a double movement when you're talking about machines. So I want to follow that. The first one is to make the bodies disappear. You make bodies appear and become sort of a text that could be read by those involved. It happens between the drug cartels.
Usted ha hablado de una serie de prácticas que son increíblemente crueles y sadistas, y son prácticas que también se han visto a veces en los Estados Unidos en términos de que aparecen los cuerpos en posiciones específicas que dan un mensaje específico a otros narcotraficantes. Y una cosa interesante que usted ha vivido a nivel de las máquinas, el hecho de que la máquina controla ese cuerpo y lo hace aparecer como un texto que a su vez está dirigido a otros carteles de drogas.
There is the opposite movement, the movement of letting bodies disappear. And in a little village nearby where I live, in Maneadero, they recently discovered a man, they arrested a man who had melted 33 bodies.
Melted
in acid.
Oh, okay.
So, well, what I'm saying is that what is being done to women, to children, to etc. is one side of the whole system that goes from exhibiting the body to making the bodies disappear.
Y entonces también existe movimiento contrario, que por ejemplo se ve en el caso de esta persona que fue encontrada, el prisionero que había derretido de cuerpos en ácido. Entonces lo que uno tiene son como los dos funcionamientos opuestos de la máquina, por un lado exhibiendo el cuerpo, por otro lado haciendo desaparecer el cuerpo.
The problem is that it is not just a question of women, although it is where it is the most the crudest and the most cruel. But the bodies disappear along the way. In other words, what's happening is that the money itself is a way of making bodies disappear and reappear without a body somewhere. Let's take an example that this money that finances the crimes goes into the country and buys legitimate businesses, institutions, hospitals, etc. So that the trace of the crime disappears. It goes from the most material to the most immaterial. From the most illegal to the most legal aspect. And it is, in fact, as you said, the whole institutional system that is itself murdered in Mexico. Because at every level, people are bought by the money, not just by the drug. because the drug is for the Americans, but the money is for investment in Mexico also. And as long as a cop is paid $300 a month, he can't resist being paid $3,000 a month. So the crime is really the corruption of the entire society. The murder made on the body of the woman is a murder made on the body of Mexico and of the institution of Mexico.
Así es.
Es correcto. That's true. That's right.
Es correcto. Para darnos una idea de la gravedad del problema, puedo citar una estadística.
And to give you an idea of the seriousness of the problem, I can quote a statistic for you.
Un investigador independiente que es asesor de la Organización de las Naciones Unidas.
An independent investigator who is also an advisor to the UN.
Además de ser investigador en la Columbia University,
also a researcher in Columbia University,
ha detectado el 75% de la economía mexicana está penetrada por el narcotráfico.
Has detected that 75% of Mexican economy has been penetrated one way or another by the drug trade.
No es un asunto solamente de narcotraficantes. Es un asunto de corrupción institucional en forma integral.
And it's really not an issue that it's limited to the drug traffickers, but it's an issue of the institutional corruption as an integral problem.
Por desgracia, las comunidades y la sociedad en ciertas partes en México se vincula cada vez más al narcotráfico por razones de supervivencia.
And unfortunately, the communities and certain groups of society in many areas of Mexico are getting more and more linked to drug trafficking just as a means of survival.
En un país con enormes desigualdades y falta de perspectiva laboral,
in a country that has enormous inequality and lack of opportunity for work,
la gente se adhiere al crimen organizado.
People get involved or get linked to organized crime.
Es un problema que va a llevar décadas restaurar en su respeto a la ley.
It's a problem that would take decades to revert, to restore the respect for the rule of law.
If I might add, all of that money, of course, doesn't just stay in Mexico. I mean, all that money goes through American banks and European banks and, you know, through the global financial system. So if it's a crime written on the body of Mexico, it's also written much more broadly.
Is it going to be
a question?
I hope this doesn't sound perverse, but it's almost easier to understand. It's almost easier to understand the economic, political incentives, the cycle. But you mentioned something, not quite in passing, and that you talked about the space that the absence of any commitment to a legal address of this left for imaginative and creative play, in the most kind of obscene way and horrifying. But I wondered if you could speak a little more, as the last person who asked a question also alluded to, about the space that's opened up to this sort of creative, imaginative, symbolic, that your thoughts on the way that plays with the real horrors of the economic and political incentives and motives, both on the macro, I mean, we understand that the money accrues internationally and to Mexico, but also the incentive for people living and for Mexicans themselves who can't get good paying work to resort to.
Global como a nivel de la gente en México que no tiene trabajo, todo
y el nivel en el cual se desarrollan las fantasías perversas en el nivel de espacio por parte de la sexualidad?
Bueno, definitivamente en el aspecto criminológico podemos detectar al menos un par de cosas.
Well, for sure, in terms of a criminological aspect, you can realize at least two things.
Por un lado, se trata de criminales que realizan estos asesinatos en busca de placer.
On the one hand, you have criminals that are committing these murders basically seeking for pleasure.
Es un producto de una sociedad patriarcal con machismo arraigado.
It's a product of a patriarchal society where machismo is deeply rooted.
La mujer es un objeto, obviamente.
The women are obviously an object.
Para estos sujetos, la mujer es como basura.
For these individuals, women is almost like garbage.
De hecho, remarcan esta significación al arrojar a las mujeres en basureros o en predios baldíos.
They, in fact, remark on this significant when they dump women in either dumpsters or just like empty lots.
Por otro lado, son crímenes de poder masculino.
On the other hand, these are crimes that had to do with an idea of masculine power.
¿Por qué especialmente? Porque eligen a víctimas pobres.
And especially because they choose their victims among the poor.
No se conoce caso de una muchacha de alta sociedad que haya sido sujeta a este tipo de crímenes en Ciudad Juárez.
There is no cases recorded of like high society women who have been subjected to these kind of crimes.
La victimología de las víctimas ha sido caracterizada por los expertos criminólogos.
The identity of the type of this victim has already been defined by criminology experts.
Se trata de niñas, mujeres, pequeñas de estatura, la mayor parte de las veces.
It's usually the case of young women or children who are short in terms of height.
Apariencia frágil de ellas.
Who look frail in appearance.
Muy atractivas o atractivas físicamente.
Attractive or very attractive physically.
En muchos casos, esto se ha repetido una y otra vez.
And in many cases, this is something that has been repeated once and then one and again.
El espacio público fue el escenario de los secuestros y también del arrojar los cuerpos.
And the public space was the space where the kidnappings and also the dumping of the bodies.
Aquí es donde estamos abarcando el concepto criminal de estos sujetos.
And that's where you're trying to round up everything that is like the criminal idea of this individual.
Para su fantasía criminal no hay límite de ningún tipo.
The criminal fantasy knows no limits.
El territorio es suyo.
They own the territory.
Y los crímenes están pensados en este dominio territorial también.
And the crimes also are thought out in terms of this dominion of the territory.
Las mujeres no tienen una entidad como personas o como seres humanos.
The women don't have an entity in terms of personhood or...
Para estos criminales son simplemente el objeto de su depredación.
For these criminals, they are just the object of the depredations.
Can I just ask
you,
I mean, you know that like ...50% of American television shows right now are about murdering women, about kidnapping women, about torturing women. I mean, it's emblemic in our society right now. I mean, every time you turn on the TV, it's either a court show about a serial murderer or it's a how to murder women.
Dice, si usted se da cuenta que el 50% de los shows de televisión americanos actualmente son acerca del asesinato y secuestro a partir de mujeres, algo está floreciendo en la televisión. Cada vez que enciende la televisión es un show que está vinculado a la corte o que tiene que ver con el asesinato serial o con el manual de instrucción del asesinato serial.
Muy interesante la cuestión.
That's an interesting issue.
Porque implica cómo está cambiando por razones de las transformaciones culturales.
Because it shows how things are changing because of our cultural transformation.
Me refiero fundamentalmente a la dialéctica entre lo real y lo virtual.
And I'm alluding mostly or basically to a dialectic between what is virtual and what is real.
Esto está proponiendo una serie de reflexiones que debemos profundizar en ellas.
And that is bringing, this is bringing up a number of ideas or thoughts that we should go deeper into.
Como sabemos, la exposición constante a la violencia tiende a conducir a la gente a la amnesia y a la anestesia frente a esta violencia.
As we all know, constant exposure to violence tends to drive people to being amnesic and just indifferent to this violence.
Es un signo fundamental de la cultura global.
And that's a fundamental trait of global culture.
Las narrativas están imponiendo esta ruptura de los límites frente a la violencia.
And the narratives are imposing this breaking of any limit in terms of violence.
Estamos viendo en los productos más recientes, por ejemplo, la novela y la película que ahora es lo más visto, que se llama Hunger Games.
And we are seeing, in terms of recent cultural products, for example, this novel and film that has been among the most watched recently.
Una narrativa que es un reflejo de las fantasías más contemporáneas.
A narrative that is a reflection of the most contemporary kind of fantasy.
Novelas para niños o para jóvenes que presentan a estos niños y jóvenes sujetos a una dinámica de exterminarse unos a otros.
Novels or narratives for young adults and kids that show these kids involved in a narrative that has to do with exterminating one another.
Yo lo ubico como una suerte de post-darwinismo.
I see this as some kind of like post-darwinism.
Donde la supremacía tiene que ser mostrada incluso a costa de aniquilar a los demás.
Wherein supremacy has to be exhibited even in terms of exterminating other people.
Reconociendo todo esto,
so if you acknowledge all of this,
yo mantengo el criterio de Susan Sontag respecto a la exposición de los hechos y de las imágenes violentas.
Although I acknowledge all of this, I still stand by what Susan Sontag said about exhibiting or showing violent images or incidents.
Es necesario que nos vinculemos y reflexionemos frente a estas imágenes violentas.
It's important or it's necessary that we feel involved and that we think about these violent images.
Porque es un modo de conocer la condición humana en su aspecto más dramático.
Because it's a way of getting to know the human condition in its most dramatic aspects.
Y a partir de este conocimiento podemos derivar un contrapeso frente a ello.
And through this knowledge we can try to come up with some kind of counterweight to it.
Dejemos que las imágenes violentas nos persigan, decía Susan Sontag.
Susan Sontag used to say, let's let violent images to stay with us.
Es la única manera que tenemos para entender lo que somos.
It's the only way we have to understand what we are.
Ocultarlas, censurarlas, dejarlas de lado es entregarse a la fantasía de la mentira.
And to hide them or censor them or leave them aside is to give yourself up to a false fantasy.
Conforme mejor conozcamos lo que somos, mejor podremos estar en condición de mejorar lo que somos.
The more we know ourselves, the more we will be we will have the ability to improve what we are.
So I'm curious about your faith in the style of the Tonight Show. I'm most familiar with the rhetoric of the rule of law of the Saturday Tonight Show as rhetoric which is used to support like police repression of activists and luchadores sociales. And so I don't know whether augmenting the rule of law in a system that is so rife with corruption will do anything to change the system. I'm skeptical.
Entonces, yo quería escuchar más acerca de esta fe que usted tiene en el imperio de la ley, porque yo personalmente me siento más familiarizado con
toda la retórica que se usa respecto al imperio de la ley para fundamentar la represión policial y la censura de las personas que lo cuestionan o los luchadores sociales. Entonces, yo personalmente soy más escéptico y me preguntaba cómo logra usted ser tan firme en esta idea de apoyar el imperio de la ley.
Porque en México no tenemos un Estado de Derecho y no hay un imperio de la ley.
Well, basically because in Mexico you don't have respect for human rights and you don't really have the rule of law.
Y por desgracia, contemplamos que el Estado y los gobiernos se endurecen cada vez más.
And unfortunately we see that the state and the successive governments get tougher and tougher.
Pero este endurecimiento no es un endurecimiento dentro del respeto a la ley.
But this toughness is not really a toughness that is conducted within a respect for the rule of law.
Es todo lo contrario.
It's just the complete opposite.
Las instituciones en México tienden a vulnerar la ley desde los principios constitucionales.
The institutions in Mexico tend to violate the rule of law, starting with the most basic constitutional principles.
El gobierno actual ha propuesto más de 20 reformas jurídicas.
The current government has proposed more than 20 law reforms.
Que en muchos casos vulneran los principios constitucionales.
Which in many cases go against constitutional principles.
Es para darle mayor fortaleza a las instituciones encargadas de perseguir el delito.
And it's supposed to give more strength to the institutions that are in charge of combating crime.
Pero a costa de no cumplir con la ley.
But this is at the expense of actually respecting the law.
Lo que yo llamo la atención es para que haya un auténtico Estado de Derecho.
So what I'm trying to call attention to is to impose a real rule of law or a real respect for human rights.
No una simulación de este Estado de Derecho.
Not just a simulation of a rule of law.
En México tenemos una enorme cantidad de policías y militares que no respetan los derechos humanos.
In Mexico you just have a huge amount of police and army men who just don't have any respect for human rights.
La tortura es habitual en las policías.
Torture is just a common practice in the police.
El ataque a las familias de las personas también.
And the attacks against the relatives of other people too.
En los últimos años ha habido un aumento de 300% de denuncias contra policías y militares por vulnerar derechos humanos.
And in the last few years there's been a 300% increase in the complaints against police and the army for infringing on human rights.
Las autoridades mexicanas aducen, defienden que este problema ya se está atacando y que son exageradas las denuncias al respecto.
And the Mexican authorities always say that they are actually fighting against this problem and that all the complaints or the denounces of these are just exaggerations.
Pero aunque esto fuera cierto, tenemos que volver a recuperar el sentido real del cumplimiento a la ley.
That even if this were true, we really need to restore a real respect for law.
I wonder if they can push that question a little farther. Because it strikes me from our perspective in the U.S., where we have enormous corruption, but it's corruption that happens within the context of law, that happens under the guise of law, that happens as law, and violence that happens under the guise of law and as law.
Desde una perspectiva americana, nosotros tenemos grandes cantidades de corrupción, pero es corrupción que ocurre dentro del contexto de la ley, bajo la apariencia de legalidad y los ejercicios de las propias leyes.
And if we consider that many of the dislocations that we've been talking about in Mexico began in 1994 with the law, do you think it's necessary to start thinking about politics, a more liberatory politics and politics of justice, which do not work in those conflicts?
Yo creo que el tema de la liberación de la economía fue como opinan expertos muy creíbles, dignos de crédito, fue un problema más político que económico.
Well, I personally think that the issue of breaking up restraints on the economy was, as the opinion of many trustworthy experts says, more a kind of political problem rather than an economic problem.
La liberación de la economía en México ha traído desde luego ventajas, pero también muchas desventajas.
And this so-called freeing of the economy in Mexico has brought obvious advantages, but also many disadvantages.
Es ahí donde tenemos que hacer una evaluación de lo que tenemos en nuestras relaciones bilaterales y trilaterales.
So that's a point where we need to really evaluate what we are getting in terms of our bilateral and trilateral relationships.
Porque de otra manera nos enfrentamos a paradojas como la siguiente.
Otherwise, you will be faced with paradoxes like this one.
A raíz de los atentados de 2001 en Estados Unidos, los atentados terroristas.
Because of the terrorist attacks in the U.S. in 2001,
el gobierno de Estados Unidos creó un acuerdo trinacional para la seguridad de América del Norte.
The U.S. government drafted a trinational agreement that was intended to bolster the safety of North America.
Esto hizo que el gobierno mexicano fuera llevado a firmar este acuerdo.
And that enticed or pressured the Mexican government to actually sign this agreement.
Sin que las instituciones mexicanas, sobre todo el área de seguridad, el ejército, etcétera, tuvieran la capacidad de enfrentar debidamente este desafío.
Without Mexican institutions, particularly in the security area, the army, etc., really having the ability to facing up to this challenge.
Este acuerdo se firmó en 2005.
This agreement was signed in 2005.
Posteriormente se firmó el Plan México, Plan Mérida, para combatir el narcotráfico.
Later on, a document called Plan Mexico or Plan Mérida was signed also to fight against drug trafficking.
Esto es lo que desata en el año de 2006-2007 la guerra del gobierno mexicano contra el narcotráfico.
And that's what makes the headlines in the year 2006-2007, this war of the Mexican government against drug trafficking.
Esta guerra ha ocasionado ya más de 50,000 muertos.
This war has already had more than 50,000 dead, has caused more than 50,000 dead.
Y lo paradójico a lo que me refería es que ahora el gobierno de Estados Unidos ya ha llamado la atención a México sobre esta enorme cantidad de personas muertas.
And what is paradoxical in all of this, what I was alluding to, is that now the U.S. government has kind of, you know, tried to reprimand the Mexican government because of the amount of debt.
Este es un resultado más de las asimetrías a las que me refiero.
Or maybe that was a misinterpretation. I tried to call the attention of the Mexican government on the amount of debt, and that's one more of these asymmetries that I was alluding to.
Ya el gobierno de Estados Unidos está alarmado por la cantidad de muertos y la ineficacia del plan de México para combatir el crimen organizado.
Now the U.S. government declares itself alarmed because of the amount of debt and the inefficacy of the Mexican government's plan to fight against drug trafficking.
Se liberó la economía, se intentó liberar la política, y las consecuencias de esta liberación no han sido suficientemente sólidas en términos institucionales.
The economy was freed and there was an attempt to free the politics, and the consequences of all this imposition of freedom has not been solid enough in terms of institutions.
Primero, además, lo quiero felicitar por su trabajo. Y quería preguntarle, usted habló de que en México siempre responde la historia a ciclos históricos, son cíclicos. ¿A qué ciclo responde? ¿De qué ciclo sale lo que estamos viviendo ahorita?
Y yo creo que tiene que ver, perdón.
La segunda pregunta que quiero preguntar, que si cree que los candidatos a la presidencia que vienen ahorita,
okay,
proponen alguna postura de verdadero liderazgo, okay, para cambiar.
cambiar la situación.
Correcto. Yo creo que...
I'm just going to summarize, but basically, he says, you pointed out that Mexican history goes in cycles, so could you identify what kind of cycle do you think we're living through? And the second question was, in terms of the candidates now running for the Mexican presidency, do you think that any of them is offering anything in terms of true leadership that could actually change or improve the situation?
Yo creo que el ciclo que estamos viviendo es un ciclo que comenzó en 1994. En 1994 en México se dio un levantamiento neo-indigenista en el estado de Chiapas.
There was a neo-indigenous uprising in the state of Chiapas in Mexico in 1994.
Es un levantamiento que causó mucho impacto a nivel mundial.
This uprising had a huge impact at the international level.
Buscaba reivindicar la presencia de los indígenas en la sociedad mexicana y en el mundo.
It was an uprising that had the intention of offering reivindication to the presence of indigenous people in Mexico and in the world, in the society.
Esta fue una rebelión, una insurrección contra las instituciones.
And this was an uprising or an insurrection that was directed against the institutions.
Asimismo, en este año de 1994 hubo asesinatos en la cúpula del poder en México.
Likewise, in 1994 there were a number of killings at the very top of the power structure in Mexico.
A partir de entonces, la curva de la violencia se ha mantenido en modo ascendente.
Since then, the curve of violence has gone in an upward movement.
Esto es lo que yo denomino un ciclo que todavía está vigente.
So that's why I personally would characterize the cycle that's still going on.
En los dos aspectos se trata de hechos contra las instituciones.
Both aspects really are incidents or events that are directed against institutions.
Y las instituciones no han podido responder a la altura del desafío.
And institutions have not been able to answer them at the level required for such a challenge.
De hecho, han sido incapaces en muchos casos.
In fact, they have been completely worthless or incapable in many cases.
Y esto hacia el futuro va a tener una importancia muy grave.
And this is going to have serious consequences in terms of the future.
Porque en muchos casos son efectos irreversibles o de largo tiempo para ser revertidos.
Because in many cases these are irreversible effects or effects that would take a long time to be reversed.
Por otro lado, México es una sociedad sumamente joven, como referí, y creciendo en su participación social día tras día.
On the other hand, Mexican society, as I mentioned before, is very young and it's increasing in terms of social participation day by day.
Hablamos desde luego de la responsabilidad institucional, pero tenemos que recordar que la sociedad debe ser más enérgica para cumplir un papel protagónico en estos momentos de crisis.
We have mentioned the responsibility of institutions, but of course we also have to remember that society has to be more emphatic so that it can be a protagonist or take a protagonist role in these times of crisis.
Esta reflexión me lleva justamente al tema de qué están ofreciendo a la sociedad los candidatos presidenciales de México.
So this reflection will take me to the issue of what are the current candidates for the Mexican presidency offering society.
Hasta ahora ninguno de los tres candidatos ha sido capaz de articular una política o una serie de políticas suficientemente convincentes para la crisis que vive México.
This far, none of the three candidates have been able to articulate a policy or a series of policies that would be trustworthy in terms of the current crisis that Mexico is going through.
Ellos tienen muy buenos diagnósticos de lo que está pasando.
They do offer a good diagnosis or good diagnoses.
Pero en cuanto empieza uno a preguntar o la sociedad cuestiona cómo van a lograr una renovación, es ahí donde ya no tienen mucho que decir.
But when one asks or when society starts demanding how they intend to manage this renewal, then they don't have much to say.
Muchas veces se quedan en las buenas intenciones.
many times is just limited to good intentions.
Y otras veces plantean seguir en la misma ruta, más de lo mismo.
Or on other occasions they just propose to continue in the same way, I mean more of the same.
Por lo tanto, vamos a enfrentar una elección sumamente competida, pero también incierta hacia el futuro.
On that account, I think we're going to be facing a very contested election, but also one that doesn't offer any guarantees for the future.
Yo creo que llevará varios años en que se forme otra cultura política en el país.
I do think that it's going to take many years for a different cultural political culture to arise in the country.
Y esa es la tarea, desde luego, de la nueva generación.
And of course, that's a task for the new generations.
Nosotros nos aproximamos a plantear los asuntos como ahora y colaboraremos en lo que sea posible para mejorar las cosas.
Our task has been to present the issues as we've done up to now, and of course, we will cooperate with anything that is possible to improve things.
Pero es claro que debido al daño que estamos contemplando, la tarea la realizarán, la culminarán la nueva generación.
But it's pretty obvious because of the damage that we've suffered that this is a task that only future generations will be able to finish.
I think we have to wind up shortly, so we'll just have one last question. Someone here hasn't asked. Oh yeah, first of all, thank you for being with us here today. That's why I wanted to say firstly. And then I have a very short question, and that is, what do women actually do to not be victims of objectifying killings on the one hand, and not be victims of an objectifying patriarchal politics on the other hand? So where's the female subject, or what is the female subject actually doing?
Okay, entonces primero que nada quería agradecerle por haber venido acá, y la pregunta que tengo es, ¿qué podrían hacer mujeres, por un lado, para no ser víctimas de este tipo de asesinatos que las cometen como objetos, y por otro, para no ser víctimas de una política patriarcal que las objetiviza? Y en ese sentido, ¿dónde es que uno encontraría la subjetividad femenina y la posibilidad de hacer algo?
Yo creo que, muchas gracias, yo creo que fundamentalmente la información es lo más importante en el primer momento.
Well, thank you. And mainly I think that information is the most important thing on a first stage.
Porque la información se convierte también en una forma de la educación.
Because spreading information also becomes a way of educating.
Me refiero a la información que se vincula a fuentes de alta credibilidad.
And I'm alluding to information that will come from sources that are very trustworthy.
Por fortuna, por las transformaciones comunicativas, tenemos acceso a mucha información que es abierta y de gran calidad.
Fortunately, because of the transformation on communication, we have access to a lot of information that is open. From open sources, and it's also high quality.
Creo que las mujeres deben vincularse más a esta información.
I think women should involve themselves more with this kind of information.
Porque esta información juega un papel preventivo, sobre todo.
Because this information also has mostly a preventive role to play.
Desgraciadamente, los asesinatos acontecen en muchos casos en mujeres muy aisladas.
Unfortunately, these killings happen in many occasions to women who are very isolated.
Que pasan por alto el propio contexto de barbarie en el que viven.
Who don't realize the context of barbarity that they live in.
Es necesario que ellas conozcan la realidad que están viviendo y hasta qué punto es grave esta realidad.
It's necessary for them to be aware, to know the reality they are living in, and to what extent this is a very serious problem.
Desde luego es una responsabilidad de las instituciones, pero también de la propia sociedad, para vincular a los sectores marginados.
It is obviously a responsibility of the institution, but also a responsibility of society itself to get marginalized sectors of society more involved.
La información, el conocimiento, la educación siempre serán procedimientos importantísimos para prevenir los crímenes.
information, knowledge, education would always be very important measures to prevent crime.
Tenemos pues que insistir en divulgar estos temas con las propias posibles víctimas.
So we have to insist in terms of spreading and communicating this issue even to possible victims.
Es la única manera que tenemos por ahora de colaborar a que cambie esta cultura de la muerte.
It's the only way we have right now to cooperate in trying to change this culture of death.
A little question, very short. I read recently in the Mexican newspapers that 55% of the political personnel are women. And I was very surprised. But is it the fact that that it is becoming dangerous to become politicians or to become part of the institutions? Do you have any explanation for that?
Yo leí, hago una pregunta breve, yo leí recientemente un periódico mexicano que el 55% de las autoridades políticas, los trabajos políticos eran totalmente mujeres, y eso me sorprendió bastante. ¿Usted cree que es un hecho que se ha vuelto actualmente peligroso ser una figura política o ser parte de las instituciones?
Bueno, yo creo que tenemos que distinguir el aspecto estrictamente demográfico del protagonismo de las mujeres en México.
Well, I think we need to differentiate between the strictly demographic aspects from the protagonic role that women are playing in Mexico's politics.
En los últimos años, en términos demográficos, hay un mayor índice de mujeres que de hombres.
Demographically speaking, in Mexico, there has been lately been more women than men.
Es un asunto muy llamativo porque tenemos un país de jóvenes y preponderantemente de mujeres.
It is something that is very noticeable because we have a country that is very young in age and is mostly feminine.
Sin embargo, las propias instituciones políticas no registran estos hechos.
However, political institutions themselves don't seem to record or to have an impact.
Las inercias patriarcales y machistas siguen imperando en la política mexicana.
There's a patriarchal inertia bred of machismo that is still basically ruling Mexican politics.
A pesar de que la ley electoral, por ejemplo, prevé cierta cuota de participación de mujeres.
Despite, for example, the electoral law disposing that there's a certain quota of women participation.
Los propios partidos políticos no cumplen esta ley.
The political parties themselves have really complied with this law.
Esto nos habla de una sociedad, la mexicana, que no se conoce a sí misma ni cree en sí misma todavía.
This speaks of a society, Mexican society, that doesn't know itself, doesn't believe itself at this point yet.
Es importante que destaquemos el protagonismo que tiene que tener la propia sociedad para cambiar un estado de hechos.
And it's important that we emphasize the protagonic role that society would need to have in order to change a factual situation.
El único contrapeso contra las instituciones deficientes es la propia presencia, protagonismo de la sociedad.
The only counterweight to any institutions that are deficient is society itself taking a protagonic role.
I think we might have to wrap it up there, but we are selling copies of Femicide Machine at the front, and I believe Sergio has kindly agreed to do a signing as well. So I hope you can join me in saying a big thank you to Sergio for very important.